Hello there, folks, and welcome to this edition of Valley Black Talk Radio on the On Me Network. My name is Julia Dudley Najee. We've got the beautiful Jewel River Smith, and yes, sometimes Mel is here, sometimes not. Fishing man, Mel Sanders.
Yeah, I gotta get back to that so I get some sanity.
You haven't gone fishing in a long time? Why not?
Are you displaying all this for our friends?
You know, they can't
I'm sorry,
see it.
I was distracted.
Luckily, we're above the table.
Okay, yeah.
Water under the bridge. That's what we call that.
Water on the sweater.
Water under the blouse.
This is a sweater, sir.
No sweater, okay.
Well, we have another. Today is Thursday, right?
Yeah. Uh-huh. Before Friday and after Wednesday, except next year.
Yeah, it was our throwback Thursday. Hey, I feel like I'm dancing from this morning.
No, I'm off till Tuesday.
Oh, that's why you're dancing.
Friday and Monday.
Wow.
Hallelujah.
It's a
praise
present.
Jehovah.
That's the same person we're talking about. Parachute contracts and all of that for public.
Oh.
And now here she is, a public servant. Not only
it's the holidays.
She getting to holiday Monday.
The holiday is also Friday. There's President's Day and Lincoln's birthday.
That was last Monday.
That was last Monday.
I know, but we celebrated this week. A Washington's birthday. Lincoln and Washington fall around the same time, so we get. I know. As my friend.
Well, I checked the mic before you guys got here.
Okay. As my friend coworker says, yeah, well, we can complain all we want, but just thank goodness we don't work in the real world. And I work hard, folks. I want you to know that, but we don't. We have
a lot. I know that Jewel works hard. So
we have a lot of blessings.
I've witnessed that. Mel, on the other hand, likes to go fishing.
Got the word like.
So, I'm not sure how hard he works, but he works at it with the fishing.
He's not even changing
what he says, Julie. You see that?
No.
Yeah, he's
well,
telling
he did work. As I say to my parents, well, you used to be gainfully employed.
Nothing wrong with it. It's a used to. It's a word
U-S-T-A.
Now.
USTA.
Oh, okay.
Why?
Ebonics in effect over here. Talk about Ebonics. Happening right here. Well, folks, we'd like to welcome you to our State of Black Central Valley. And this is an important topic because we covered education for the last week and a half.
Yeah.
Now we're going to talk about economics.
And money.
Okay, sing it because everybody wants to know,
money.
Right? That's right, Joe. Everybody wants to know. And people think it's just about the money, but there's a lot more to it than just the money.
Saving.
There's the savings.
Planning.
There's the planning.
Retirement.
There's all that stuff. So we have some experts that are going to be called. One is calling in, John Brown, out of the Southern California area. And then Marshall and Govan, who we know, whose business is right here in the Fresno area. And so he's from insurance to burial insurance to all the stuff that we've talked about. We're going to keep talking about it until people get it right and understand how important it is.
You better do that. You got a president that's going to make you do that.
Yeah, we have, but we're not going to talk about it right now. We'll talk. Can we talk about it? We're going
to
talk about
the elevator did not go to the top floor.
Because they didn't know that before.
No.
You just want more proof where none is needed.
Yes. Let's pile it on.
Hey, in the last 15 minutes, we're going to cover that so we can at least talk about it. That's why at least we are starting on time, and hopefully that audience is with us tonight. And on Sunday, well, I'm going to talk about that upcoming event. First, I want to get to upcoming events, and then I'll tell you what's going to happen on Sunday, our guests that are coming in. I gave you and Mel each a card. Mel,
I thought
your card?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah.
So let's go to those upcoming events, please. First, I want to make sure you all know about the Trailblazer exhibit. It is not over, folks. All the way to March 4th. Please feel free to call in and set up a tour, 559-544-1857. So this Red Tail exhibit really displays the Tuskegee Airmen.
Mm-hmm.
This is part of our American history, folks.
They're
always
tails.
Red
okay,
tails.
Okay, you said Trailblazers. I didn't know
my
it was
God.
A Trailblazer.
See how tired I am?
I
see what I mean? I'm sorry.
Believe it.
I'm glad you corrected me. I meant the darn Red Tails. Thank you, Jill, for
you
that correction.
You did say Red Tails second time.
Okay, yeah. I do apologize. Red Tails, which really is talking about the history of our Tuskegee Airmen. So we hope that you get to enjoy this mobile exhibit. If you missed the reception, make sure you go to the closing reception March 4th, where we got, again, it was great to have these gentlemen come in and show the movie, mm-hmm. explain. People got to ask questions.
Yep.
I mean, it was just so phenomenally nice.
It was.
And we'd like to thank the California Arts Council because it's a grant that we got, 2-year grant.
Thank you, California Arts Council.
Thank you. Bringing arts to the valley. Yes. So we're really excited about that.
Yeah.
Now, this you see on the screen. Okay, Sunday. You don't want to miss Sunday. Valley Black Talk Radio, right here from 6 to 8. Mel, you got to hear a little bit about these brothers right here. You got, in fact, you got to see Reggie.
Yes.
Remember we?
Yes.
And you heard just a little bit that he said. Well, just a little bit that he said. Do you think it's helpful to everybody?
Oh, yeah. Most definitely.
Not just businesses. I mean to
everybody.
People.
From the big shop to the little shop. He's the wannabe shop.
You know how many people he helped that night? Almost everybody in that room. They call, I mean, he's been getting slammed by everybody in that room because he knows how to fix credit. Where it's not as expensive, but it's worth it. It's
not
a value.
That, he knows access to the capital.
Exactly.
Yes.
Well, I want them to tell it. So the owner, Tamari Story Harden, he's going to be here along with Reggie Burns, who's actually from back east, who's coming out here to.
Oh, okay. These are for Sunday.
Yeah, that's okay. For Sunday. So I'm just saying, pass the card to somebody because they're going to want to. Trust me, they're going to want to meet. Tamari, I mean, sorry. Tamari, but these brothers are so good. Please pass this card on to somebody. In fact, take it off that screen real quick, Lynn. They're so good that they're just so relaxed about it.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, yeah, we can fix your credit.
It's in there.
Yeah,
they don't have to think about it.
Yeah, okay, mm-hmm. So what's the issue? Yeah, oh, you just got to come in. We can fix it. It's like it doesn't matter how bad you think it is.
Mm-hmm.
And he says, you know, black people always think that it's so bad that it can't be fixed. Mm-hmm. And he said, this is not the case. You got to know how the game is played.
Yeah.
It's a game.
Number one thing we have to do as a community is quit being so private. So
that's what they said.
That's our biggest problem.
That's what
we
they
don't
said.
Want anybody to know the things are bad, and so we just fake it and fake it and fake it and fake it to go away, and it really hurt us more than it's helping us.
And you know what's so sad?
Other folks
do it all the time.
No, I don't care about that. Mm-mm. If they need to, they'll file bankruptcy, and before it gets the final, before the ink gets dry, mm-hmm. there's some applications coming in the mail
yep.
for you. You want
that's
to do
right.
That?
Yep.
Yeah.
And that's what they said. We're too personal with it. We're too emotional about it. And instead, you know, we go about the wrong way, and then we're scared to get it fixed as we want anybody to see. And he said, it doesn't matter.
And it's like the credit counselor, trust me, he's seen credit worse than yours. I don't care what your credit is like. He's
yep.
seen worse.
And but they're able to fix stuff. And they've done several of the folks that I hope call in and do some testimonials, people that we know personally that are supposed to be telling other people. But here's my problem with that. I'm afraid that those people aren't going to tell anybody because they don't want folks to know that they had bad credit.
Yeah,
but they need to tell
fixed?
Somebody because they got it free. So
yeah.
they need to tell somebody. You need to start telling people, so I'm going to start calling you out. I know your names.
Yeah, but see, when you join
I know your names.
And your life has been changed, you would want to tell somebody.
Especially got it for free.
Yeah.
Especially if you got it for free.
Well.
And my thing is, you know, do some of ours on here. I'll shout it out. Shoot. I'll be like, yes, they did fix my credit and everybody. What? What?
Well,
no, it's a good comparison. It's just that usually people at church want you to think they were much worse than they ever were. They smoked a joint once in high school, half a joint with somebody else.
Once a week.
But then when they go to testify,
once
a week.
I was a pothead. I was the worst pothead you ever saw. And meanwhile, people going, I know him. He ain't never smoked more than a half a joint. So at church, they try to play up.
Oh.
They're negative because then you can see how saved they
okay.
are. Where with credit.
I didn't realize that.
Yeah, with credit, people don't necessarily want to talk about
it. They get quiet all of a sudden.
Yeah.
Folks, if you want to change your life and change your experience in wealth, you're going to want to know these brothers and you're going to want to go to them, I'm telling you. Because it's more than necessary to have credit in the society. There's just no way around it. Okay?
Good credit. Bad credit costs you more on your car loan, more on your house loan.
But you need to know it's done purposely to sometimes folks of color.
But it costs you more for everything.
You rattle it out pretty fast. How you know about that?
How you think I know? Because somebody rear-ended me, and I ended up getting the bad credit from not paying the insurance on the rental car that they rented for me, even though I went and got the car and told them, I have insurance. I don't need this daily insurance. Mm-hmm. I told them three different times, Enterprise.
They did me wrong, too. They did me like that.
And they still added the and I said, I'm not paying that because I told you three times. I brought you my insurance papers. Mm-hmm. You said, well, I'm sure it was just a mistake. Yeah, I know it was a mistake. Yeah. Now take it. And they never, so that is the short version. And I know it was the principal. And
I don't rent from Enterprise to this day. I do not rent from Enterprise to this day.
But I was not willing to pay that $398.
Yep. I will not rent from them to this day.
here.
I got my own. I know.
You got your own. You're supposed to give that to someone else because I've got more cards here. Seriously, pass it to someone else because after they listen to the show on Sunday, they're like, oh, man, let me call them.
But they're here on Sunday. No, you didn't hear me, baby girl. I am not working. So I'm not going to see anybody.
Well, you'll miss out.
I might leave the house.
Okay.
I won't see anybody until I see you guys on Sunday.
Oh, that's what I was talking about.
Anyone else will have to be in my house.
Well, then you hang on to that because maybe there's somebody next week if you don't want it, but I know you'll want it because littlest things or just pass it on.
Yeah. And I will be telling people to listen.
Yes, they're going to want to listen on Sunday. So I'm excited that they're going to come in and talk about it and explain it. It's not as hard as people think. Mm-hmm. It's just being proactive.
And being willing to say,
yes,
I messed up, or somebody messed me up.
Or somebody messed you up.
Yeah.
You know, we all have kids. My kids have messed me up.
Yeah, okay? I'm really looking forward to talking to them because I have written to TransUnion. I have written to Experian.
Doesn't matter.
They say, you know, go ahead and write. Mm-hmm. That's how you get stuff off your. Nope. 60 Minutes showed a long time ago. They look at those letters and toss them in the round file.
It goes somewhere else, but it doesn't go to fix your credit. So I'll be excited about that.
Yeah.
And then meanwhile, we are going to be talking with John Brown, who's looking at black economics. And we have to talk about black economics because we think it's just with black businesses. But I will say this because I know that black chambers throughout the nation are supposed to be helping with some of the basics of startup businesses or black businesses in general. I think the one in this town is doing a revamp. I think they had an event tonight. Gosh, they could have been on the show. We called you 3 weeks ago, Fresno Metro Black Chamber of Commerce. Yes, I call people out when you don't call back. So they had an opportunity to call us back. We left a message. Linus left a message. This would have been perfect to be on the economics to start.
They are the changing chamber.
Chamber to change that image. Mel?
So I saw the email that came to me. Are they looking for looking to hire someone?
They already did for the CAO president. They already did. Remember I was telling you the two people?
I just saw the letter today. I just assumed that's what it was. Email today.
Today? No, they were having a mixer today. I think there's something tonight. There's something tonight in Southwest Fresno. They had how to have a successful black business. That was tonight. So maybe, I mean, unless it was something like their first Fridays they usually have.
No, this was about hiring someone.
But they did that. Okay, we'll talk about that at the break, I'll tell you. So my point is they should have been on at least one of these economic shows, and we did reach out to them, just letting folks know, because we know that the community has questions about this particular organization, and part of it is because of, number one, transparency, and number two, how are you connecting with all of the businesses? Mm-hmm. How are you...
Are you connecting?
Instead of just wanting a membership saying, well... Yeah. Like what somebody said to us from the chamber, we won't say any names, when they made the comment, well, you guys should just be donating to us because we're the chamber. No, as a black business, I'm not giving you my $150 just because I should.
Yeah.
That's not how that works for any black business.
Just because they think you should. You don't think you should.
Right.
You know, I join a membership organization for some kind of benefit
not
of
because
being in
I
that member
should.
Organization. Yeah. Right.
And so I want to put that out there because that's a lesson for you all who are on that board. Maybe some of you all work jobs. You might want to get people on there that either can be a consultant or that have a business or that run a business on the side. And they'll tell you people aren't just going to donate to you.
They're not just going to donate just because. And they're not just going to walk in either.
Right.
I always wonder, like, how are they identifying businesses and are they going out into the neighborhoods meeting new business owners and old business owners for that matter?
Right.
You know, are they, what is their outreach strategy? That's.
And so that would have been great to have the new, and we'll still put that offer out there. It just won't be the next few weeks because we're doing our state of Black Central Valley. We still got media and social injustice, so many other things we have to cover. But maybe March will come on and be able to, and maybe the new CEO can come on and tell us what's happening.
March.
In March, they can come in and maybe talk to us and find out what the
CEO?
I'll tell you at the break.
Okay.
Until they do the announcement, we're not going to do it.
What else would be really important is sharing with African Americans in particular who are in business about the importance of utilizing their ability to donate to a cause and it not hurt their bottom line.
Mm-hmm.
I know three or four people who are in business who don't take advantage of making a contribution to something that helps their community. Mm-hmm. They simply just don't do it. Even though they can do it and get tax credit for it, so they don't have to give it to Uncle Sam.
Well, that's one. That's a question you want to definitely bring up to Marshawn Govan when he comes in at 7, because with his, that's what he does from taxes to accounting.
Okay,
that would be perfect to bring that up to
him. Chamber offering that as a service to African American, because they don't understand. So, I know they need to do it.
But they're a 501. They're not a 501c3. They're a 6.
Oh,
they're a membership organization. They're a 501c6.
That means
you don't get a write-off.
They're a different kind of nonprofit.
It's a different type of, it's a membership organization versus a nonprofit.
So since they take in money.
Wait, what does that look mean, Jewel? He did a smile and then he turned.
He's not sure about that.
And then he pursed his lips.
All right. Like you told me.
Okay, well, that's what we were told when other folks were asking about write-off. Only write-off you can do is if you're a business, you can say it's a membership organization, a business membership organization, you can write off that way. Mm-hmm. But it's not quite the same, according to my CPA, as a write-off if I'm giving to the museum.
Yeah, people are familiar with 501c3, but there's a whole bunch of, there's like from 1 to 6.
Right.
And you could be a 501c5, 501c3,
and there's
4,
C6.
Whatever, and they're different.
Yeah, they're a C6. So maybe Mel will help enlighten us about whatever it is he wants to tell us about that, huh?
You bet.
Oh, goody, gum drops. Also, any other local news that we need to be discussing and talking about? Oh, Rapid Alert. Let me talk about that one more time. You guys will be seeing this also during the break. It's a longer version of why you need to make sure that if you as a parent or legal guardian are signed up to the Rapid Alert text system. And the Rapid Alert text system, if you can click on that, my dearest friend as the engineer, like today. Was he on his phone?
No.
No.
He doesn't even have anything in his ears.
That's
no headphones
much
in his ears.
Worse.
That means he's listening.
That's much
no,
worse.
No, he's listening.
If he was, it'd be on rapid text alert right now. If he was.
Come on, Linus the Menace.
It was even labeled in the title. Anyways, talking about the rapid text alert system, this is something that's been put in place by Fresno Unified School District for parents to be able to communicate. Now, other schools are doing this throughout the state, including Fresno State that already does something like this since from shootings around
Fresno
the campus.
City.
Yeah, Fresno. Does Fresno City have it too?
Mm-hmm. It's not called rapid alert,
but it's
the
similar?
Same thing. Yeah, you got to opt in, and then when anything is going on,
see, what happens if you don't opt in? You're not going to get the messages,
no,
right?
You will not get the messages if you don't opt in.
And Fresno City College can't keep emailing you, to texting you to opt in either.
No. You get one or two messages. And
that's it. And the reason why is because there's charges with that, and they know that some cell phones get charged for that. So they're trying to be respectful. They ask parents to opt in. If you're a Fresno Unified School District parent or legal guardian, opt into the system. That way you know what's going on if there's an emergency at that school site. I've been there, done that. Because technology is
had
here.
Had an emergency where you didn't know what was going on because they didn't have the opt-in yet? Yeah.
And so what kids were doing, because phones, they had their cell phones, they were texting what they heard. Mm-hmm. So one student from another classroom would say, hey, this is what I heard. And they text that other one. Mm-hmm. And then, then it goes out to the parents, and we have all these parents just upset in front of the Fresno High campus. Give me my baby. I need to come get my baby. I remember one parent was just upset. And the shooting, it wasn't even a shooting, but somehow it became a shooting that was on campus.
And that's what it became.
Yeah.
Isn't it amazing how
that's not what it was.
You can start the secret on this end, and you know we always say you go 10 people. You don't have to go 10. You go 3 people, and it'll be completely different by the time
it
comes out the
and
other
so
side.
And so we're trying. Parents, we don't want them to have to get the wrong information.
Yeah.
Because I didn't like that. I mean, that is stressful when you're just sitting in the classroom.
Yeah.
Like,
or no information.
Right. Right.
Which is worse.
And before they would, this is what they would do: is tell us teachers and send it to the email. But we weren't allowed to tell the students. Mm-hmm. So then the student, but there's always one teacher that slips up. Always one. It's always
slips up?
Yeah.
Or
or a substitute that just reads it off to the class.
Yeah.
Hey guys, this is what the email says. It says not to read it, but I'm going to read it to you anyway.
That's what. Because I don't work here.
And then those, yeah, right? So then those students would say, and they would text to the other students and saying, mm-hmm. hey, our substitute teacher said, this is what's going on. And then that would get out to the parents, and then we get out to the news. You had news trucks out there. Oh, it was terrible. Terrible. So finally they got the rapid text alert where parents will get the firsthand information. Mm-hmm. Take a look at the commercial when we're on that break. It's a long commercial where you have the acting superintendent talking about that. And that's the rapid text
alert. But he also included in his message that if you opt into this, you will have a voice in who's going to be the next superintendent.
I don't think that relates. Oh. I'm not sure that relates. How did he disequate that to what we're talking? Can you just, Jill, help fill me in on what just happened?
You know, people to sign up.
Let me tell you.
He could have told me that memo
yeah,
at
but
the
answer was no, so now.
How are people going to sign up now? Are they going to sign up now because of that? Jeez. Yeah, but at any rate.
Funny, one or two.
Yeah, people are going to sign up. Well, Mel said on that Valley Black Talk Radio.
Oh, yeah. So I want to know, can I
get
my cousin a job?
Yeah.
He got a degree.
Of understanding?
A degree of understanding. And and speaking of understanding, folks, we want people to know what's going on at all times. And one of the things that we treasure on the Omni Network is being able to give you unfiltered information and news. So go to the website if you ever want to know what's happening from California-wide, Central Valley-wide. We have a lot of partners that we repost or put news articles, originals up there. And we also ask you to sign up on the Omni News list so that you can just get the email and download the free app.
Yep.
Those are all the ways to stay in tune. Because this is what we found out. So there was a meeting a couple weeks ago. I want to say right before that Red Tails reception. Mm-hmm. A community meeting, and I keep hearing the same thing. How are black people getting their information? How are they communicating? And I know that's going to be on the media portion when we really talk about it. Mm-hmm. But a lot of them that aren't watching TV,
yeah,
they're not listening to the radio, and they're not on Facebook. So my question is, how do you get what's going on within the black community at all?
You called Julia. I believe it was you who texted me the information from Viva Strouder about that meeting.
That's correct.
Which I would not have known if you hadn't texted me.
Right.
So just call Julia. She knows everything that's going
God.
On.
Probably won't pick up the phone. But
if you check with your local pastor, then you get the word.
Do you know what's going on?
No. No, you see how he's doing this? You see how he's just slipped that in there? Did you get that?
And I must
and you
say.
You were gullible.
No, I made a remark about that in
the
community
did.
Meeting.
Okay.
About, I don't know why Brand is going to these pastors when churches are not political bodies.
Right.
Now, I mean, they may discuss politics not from the pulpit, mm-hmm. but they're not, you know, I just.
Well, what did
we
they
don't
say?
Want to digress,
so that's the meeting I'm talking about. So the one person that came from that meeting mm-hmm. said that we all need to be on the same page, that mm-hmm. black folks don't communicate all the same way
yeah.
in the community.
Yeah, there were.
But we're the commonality. Black media is the commonality with
yeah,
that.
Yeah, well, it was an interesting meeting. I enjoyed it. It was mm-hmm. a good meeting, but there were only 8 people there. And I'm sorry, 10 people plus. The host
right.
and I don't say that to denigrate the meeting
right.
like I said it was a good meeting mm-hmm. but yeah how did they get the word out because there should have been a lot more than 8 people
well,
I mean there must be more than 8 people in the city of Fresno that would have been
right.
interested
right.
and able to attend
but had we gotten the information I'm just giving
right.
people example
yeah.
had AMPTV or OnMe gotten the information we would
yeah.
have been able to blast it on Valley Black Talk Radio
exactly.
blast it on the morning show blast that in between programming so people
mm-hmm.
would know about it
yeah.
and not that that's the only way but that's a very effective way to mm-hmm. get the information out there
yes it is
so well when we get to our media bit we'll have to really discuss that and break that down to people when we talk about our media and social justice why the two are actually pertinent and work together and go mm-hmm. hand in hand it's very important
yeah it is.
This is as important as economics. I guess every topic is important. So is the politics. I can't
well,
wait to
all
the
that. Ones that we're discussing,
yeah.
education, economics, what were we doing? Politics.
Yes.
Yeah, they're all
they're
so
all
important in our community.
Right.
Yeah.
So
I mean, in every community, but especially ours. White folks, you know, they don't have too much to worry about when it comes to money, except for the people who worked in manufacturing and lost their jobs after all those Republican presidents.
We're going to go to break because Jill's about to start a war. I see Mel waking up from his slumber, and he wants to say something. but he's keeping his mouth tight-lipped. Did you see that tight lip? Hey, you're watching the Valley Black Talk radio special, State of Black Central Valley. We're going to be right back. Stay with us. We're going to have our guest, John Brown from the Bedford Group, who's going to be calling in. And we're also going to have Marshawn Govan at the 7 o'clock hour, who's going to help us with taxes and accounting and getting our books straight. And then I can't wait till Sunday, too. I mean, all of it's good stuff. So stay with us. We'll be right back.
John Brown.
My teachers and principal work really hard to keep my school safe so I can spend time on my favorite subjects.
But sometimes emergencies happen, and our schools have to take action to ensure our safety, including notifying parents. Make sure your emergency contact information is current with the school office. Fresno Unified is launching Rapid Alert, a new emergency text notification system in the event there is a safety issue at our schools.
When you receive the Rapid Alert text, please opt in so that we can continue to be safe.
Attention, are you stuck in student loan debt? If you owe $10,000 or more in federal student loans and are having trouble making your payments, call now to see if you are eligible for a reduction in your student loan payments. Living under the pressure of student loan repayment can feel like drowning sometimes. You may even be late or in default on your loans. Give us a call now for a special free offer. The call is free and the information is free, and there is no obligation. Imagine living a life unburdened by student loan debt. This future may be only one free call away. Student loan debt relief can help stop tax garnishments and release cosigners. We've helped many people struggling with their student loan payments. Call us now to see if we can help you get on the path to a student loan debt-free future. Call 800-946-8578. That's 800-946-8578.
Did you know that having health insurance is the law? If you can afford health insurance but chose not to get it for 2016, you may be required to pay a fee, sometimes called the penalty, fine, or individual mandate, when you file your 2016 federal income taxes. The good news is, ICAN Benefit can help you save on health insurance and get you covered the same day for the future. For 2016, the fee is $695, or 2.5% of your income, whichever is higher. For many people, that's more than the yearly cost of our health plans. For tax year 2017 and beyond, the percentage option will remain at 2.5%, but the flat fee will be adjusted for inflation. This could end up costing you hundreds or even thousands of dollars every year, and that doesn't even account for any medical services you may require. Call ICAN now. Health insurance is the law.
Call 800-650-2779. That's 800-650-2779.
US Med has great news for anyone living with diabetes.
If you have Medicare, private insurance, or prescription drug coverage, US Med will ship a new glucose meter right to your home.
And shipping is free.
My new meter uses only a speck of blood, so it's less painful than my previous meter.
If you have Medicare, private insurance, or prescription drug coverage, you're covered with US Med. We're welcoming new patients, even if your current provider can't supply you anymore.
I don't even have to test on my fingers anymore. I can test on my hand or forearms, and it's more accurate than my old meter.
So call US Med today, and you'll have a choice of two great meters.
One that actually speaks your results. Or a meter that takes less blood and can even Bluetooth to your phone.
Act now, and US Med will include a free prescription discount card. We'll also send you a free diabetes cookbook. This is your opportunity.
So call US Med today.
You'll be glad you did.
If you owe $10,000 or more to the IRS or state, this may be the most important phone call you'll ever make.
I owed $87,000 in taxes. But listen.
Your tax problem is settled. You only owe $3,500.
What a great message.
If you owe $10,000 or more to the IRS or state, then you owe it to yourself to call this number. Let our experts help guide you through the process of negotiating a tax settlement. Call this number or go to tax10000.com.
Snacking has never been this exciting. At Graze.com, we combine wholesome ingredients with the flavors we all love to create over 100 exciting snacks, like these. We'd love to send you a Graze sampler box for free. Just go to Graze.com, enter the code ENJOY12, and we'll mail your free box to your home or office. Join thousands of Grazers already in love with our exciting snacks. So come to Grays.com for your first box free.
Attention Medicare patients. This is an important message from Medical Supply Helpline.
If you struggle with back or knee pain, you could receive a brace at little or no cost. Medical Supply Helpline connects you with a knowledgeable customer service representative that's available right now. The call is free, there's no paperwork to sign, and Medicare is billed directly. Call us today.
To learn more, call Medical Supply Helpline at 800-533-1394.
This is an important medical message from the Pain Management Network. Do you suffer from severe back or knee pain, making even your most simple everyday activities difficult? Well, if you're on Medicare, we have great news. You can now receive a pain-relieving knee or back brace at little or no cost to you. We'll handle the paperwork with Medicare for free. All shipping and customer service is free. And the call to check your eligibility is free.
Call now at 800-235-2801, 800-235-2801.
Technology has been around for a while, and it's important, you know, as you see things happen across the nation, that we do everything we can to ensure the safety of all of our students. So as it's come up, we wanted to make sure we were doing it and doing it well, that we have the opportunity to communicate in a way that as many parents would have the opportunity to opt in. You know, as with our EduTech system, which we have for school attendance and grade data, there are 70,000 students. We have 20,000 people signed up for that. We believe that this is one that we really want people to sign up for because we want people to have safety information in live time. Nothing particular, you know, precipitated us doing it other than it doesn't take a lot of searching to recognize that these incidents occur, and we want to be proactive in making sure that nothing occurs in front of us and we find that we're not adequately prepared to respond to. If that situation on a school campus was something that necessitated either the student's school being dismissed or something that interrupted the total flow of school, that would be something that we'd send an EduText for. If it were something that was that site leaders had responded to and that situation was contained, it's potential that we would not necessarily do that, which is not to say we would not communicate it. We would communicate it by other means. This is really about urgent situations in live time that require a response. If a parent feels like the school might not have their accurate data, you could go in right away, talk to the school office manager or the student attendance person at the front office and say, I need to fill out an alternative emergency card and give them their newest contact information. If there's a card on file, they'll simply make those modifications and make those changes in the system. Or if there's not a card on file, we need to have that card on file right away. It's not unusual for parents to have cell phone plans that may go off in periods of time. Some people have temporary phone plans. If that's the circumstance, it's really crucial that as the new phone number comes online, that it's given to the school site, and then that's reflected in our student database. But this specific system here is really about responding to things in live time so that we can tell parents where they need to go or what would be the best thing to do so that they know how to move in a situation that requires urgency. In fact, some of the sample messages that you see dictate some of the things that they would need to do in that regard. If, for example, the school is being closed early, for example, in the case of a gas leak, it would say, we would ask you to come and pick up your student as soon as possible. And it would give them directions if there was a place to do that. For example, let's say the students were dismissed to the backside of the campus as with a fire situation and they're deployed to the backside of the campus. The rapid alert message would, you know, it's only 160 characters, but we would give as much specificity as we could, telling the parents where they would need to arrive and how to go about picking up their child. That's the goal. If the emergency card has multiple numbers and those multiple numbers are in the system, then those multiple numbers would be put into the rapid alert system and those people would be contacted as well. You want that level of duplicity. You know, some people have, there's any number of different reasons. You might have other people in your card that you want to have know about what's happening with your child. Again, our intentionality here is to make this as broadly understood as it can be, to communicate to as many involved families, guardians, and community members as we can. I need to reiterate again, it's crucially important that the school have your correct information on file, and that as that information changes, you need to change it with us in live time. Before, normally we would use that phone messenger system. The problem with phone messenger in terms of its being immediate, I can give you a scenario that we had where there was a power outage, so we used the phone messenger system. That could go out in English immediately, but for it to go out in Spanish and Hmong simultaneously, it requires translation. So we had a situation, if that took 30 minutes for that message to be translated and dismissed, that power may be back on by the end of that time frame. So The advantage of this, because it's only 160 characters, it's immediately translated into both Spanish and Hmong and distributed. I can't speak to other schools that are using this, but I know that this type of technology is used across the state. If you know, Fresno State, for example, has the Bulldog Alert System, which is not unlike what we're talking about here with Fresno Unified's Rapid Alert System.
Welcome back to Valley Black Talk Radio, special State of Black Central Valley. And as we told you, we are focusing on economics. This is part one. So those of you who are watching, you know that you can call in because we do have experts that we are lucky to be able to have on the show tonight and also on Sunday. So tonight, in just a moment here, we'll be featuring John Brown, who is an associate at the Bedford Group. And he's going to get, we have a theme to this, folks. We're talking about economics. We can't just talk about it. We have to be about it and figure out what are some challenges, identify that in our community, and what are we going to do about it.
Yeah.
And that means all the way around. This isn't just businesses, even though that's part of it. You also have the average citizen from lower class, upper middle class. We all have issues when we're talking about economics within the Black community.
Oh, yeah.
And everybody has to play a role. So we're going to be discussing that tonight. And just giving everyone a little bit other things that, I mean, other guests we're going to be having in is Marshawn Govan around the 7 o'clock hour after that break. But we first want to welcome Mr. John Brown, who is calling us within California, but still in another city. So we appreciate that he's able to call in this evening. Mr. John Brown, how are you doing this evening?
I'm doing great. Thank you for...
And so if you can tell us more about your background from finance, because I know you've worked for and also produced major companies, help people to get money, help people get finance, and then tell us where you're at now. We want to be able to talk about the Greenwood Project that you have going and why it's so important and how that's going to strengthen the middle class as you also stay in your mission. So we'll, with no further ado, we'll let you have the floor there.
As you know, I'm a real estate developer with the Bedford Group. But my present activity as I mature is with an entity I've created called Abaco Partners.
Okay.
And Abaco Partners has introduced something called a Black Economic Index. And that index indicates that we're at 5.2% of par. In short, if 100 is par, we're only at 5.2% of par in America. So us as African Americans have a lot of work to do to get on par. And the USA Today says take us 9 generations, 338 years to get on par.
Oh boy.
I believe we can do it in one generation. And it's really by learning to invest in ourselves. If we invest in ourselves, if we invest in growing bigger businesses, we have 2.5 million businesses, of which only 2.3 million have one employee. But yet we have 14% of the population, we provide a very small percentage of the jobs. So if we build bigger businesses, our unemployment will be on par. If we build bigger businesses, our medium household income, instead of being 60% of par, to reach par, because we'd be creating more and better paying jobs, and we'd be creating more executive jobs. Our Black medium family wealth is 8, 9, 10% of par. And it's not higher because we don't build assets.
Mm-hmm.
So we have we don't transfer assets to the next generation. And because we don't invest as a whole as much as others. So we don't build passive income. We don't tend to put money where we can't control it.
Hmm.
So if you take the revenue generated by our businesses only generate $187.6 billion in revenue. To be on par, they need to be generating closer to $2 trillion in revenue. And if they were generating $2 trillion in revenue, it would take care of the unemployment. It would take care of the difference in the medium household income. It would take care of the difference in the medium family wealth if the generation of that new income is based on us investing in us. So we're at a period where we have to, in the next generation, as quick as we can, and I believe we can do it in 20 to 25 years, get on par. The metrics say we have 15 million families. And if 1% of those, if each family invested 1% of its income, and our business is growing 12% a year in volume, we would be on par in less than 25 years. So that means if you earn $1,000 and you invested $10, 1%. So we know 15 million families won't invest, but that's the example of how easy it is for us to get on par. But it's something we can't procrastinate on. We have to do. We have to do. So what I do at Abaco is I'm really sharing with our people the idea of building wealth by building assets. So if you're not building a business, and if you're building a business, you still need to have some passive assets. All of your net worth, all of your wealth shouldn't be in the business. So the idea here is to teach building wealth, which means primarily the acquisition of passive assets. So it means saving some of what you earn and making investments, safe investments, stable investments, and speculative investments. And it's just allocating and building your portfolio of assets. That's where we are as a people. And that's where we are individually. Individually, we need to work toward the goals of being employed and planning our career. We need to work toward having income that's comparable to par. We need to work toward having net worth that's comparable to par. But our net worth, our wealth ought to be off what we've invested in other black businesses. So just like we said, we need to buy black, we need to invest black.
Okay.
And we need to make them impact investments. Impact investments that make a profit and have a social benefit.
So you said something very I'm sorry. You said something very different.
The Green Wealth Project.
Okay. So, Mr. Brown, I just want to make sure I clarify. You said instead of buying black, we need to invest black, right?
Oh, no. I didn't say instead of. Well, we need to buy black, but we need to invest black.
Both.
See,
okay.
When we're buying black, we ought to be spending money we have to spend anyway. We're buying things that we have to buy anyway.
Okay.
So we ought to consciously spend black. We have to do. That's part of how our businesses will grow 12%.
Mm-hmm.
But we have to build assets so we can build wealth, and you build assets by making investments. So we got to make black investments. So we don't do one instead of the other.
Okay.
We need to buy black, but we need to invest black too. And notice, I'm saying 1%, 2% of your income, if you invested it black, we could get on par.
Okay.
So we need to think investing too.
Okay.
And that brings up the project that we're promoting now. You know, we promote different things. You know, we raise money for companies, but with the Jobs Act, we can now raise money from unaccredited investors. It's that all of us working class people who aren't sophisticated investors, who don't have $1 million in net worth and don't make $200,000 to $300,000 a year every year, we now have the right to invest. By law, you know, there's a Job Act saying unaccredited investors can be recruited to take money.
Okay.
And this is something Obama did. So this gives us an opportunity to really catch up. So instead of us sitting around waiting on wealthy black Americans to invest in us and give us money for what we're doing, we can do regulated crowdfunding, and we can advertise and market to all of our people. And people can invest at $1 a share at a minimum of $100. So we have a broad pool of people we can go after now. And the Greenwood Project has successfully registered on a platform and have a portal where they're raising $1 million. And they're asking every black American to invest. And so if they got 10,000 to invest 100, they would have $1 million. Right now they have about, I think they have about 86 investors. And they raised since the first of the year, $54,800. They have 86 investors, and they raised almost $55,000. Hmm. In the next 80 days, about 80 days, they need to raise another $950,000 by May 1st. Hmm. So everyone needs to know that they can go to Greenwood, thegreenwoodproject.net, and they can read about it, and they can make an investment. And there's not a lot of due diligence to do. This is a speculative investment. This is a startup by someone who finished college in June. They have no experience in what they're doing.
Well, why would we invest?
They have the tenacity to register this with the SEC, and they say, help me get $1 million so I can try to do it.
So here's the problem.
I like us, those who can afford to take the risk to do it. Now let me pause.
Okay. Yes, so the question that us hosts and other viewers might have as they're listening to someone that just graduated, and they just graduated in June, and they don't have any experience, how would we make them feel comfortable, especially when you're talking about African Americans? Well, we have a problem with trust as it stands. What would you tell that person?
I would tell that person this is no different than a lottery ticket. It's not something they should feel. This is something they should take a risk on. Remember I said there are three classifications of investment. There's those that are speculative, there's those that are stable, and there's those that are safe. This is not safe or stable. This is speculative. So those of us who are willing to and understand that the speculative investments have to be made too, and you don't put all your money in speculative investments, that's what we're talking about. If some people just put 100 up. So people who aren't interested and they think the risk is too great shouldn't do it. But all of those who understand that and who spend more than that on lottery tickets every month, this is much better than the lottery, but there is risk.
Okay.
And it isn't about can the person do it or will they be able to do it. This is about taking a chance.
Okay, there's a question.
And we're hoping, because I vetted the person, that the people who believe in my success record realize that this young man has a chance of being successful more than some other ventures. I am supporting him. I'm gonna put $25,000 or $50,000 in. I'm gonna match 2.5% to 5% of what he raised. So
okay, there's a question for you.
Check.
We have a question for you. Okay, Jewel, one of our hosts has a question. Go ahead.
Yeah. So, Mr. Brown, I can understand, having invested before, that some things are risky, and you the benefit of risk is that the payoff can be higher than a safe investment.
Right.
But this young man or any person that would be involved with Greenwood, Green Ridge,
the Greenwood Project.
Yes. Okay. Is there any, what is the criteria? Because even if he hasn't done this before or done it yet, if I know someone has a business plan on file and has the proper consultants in place and all that, even though it's a risk, I feel okay about it. But if he's brand new to business and there's no...
That's why I asked you to visit the website, thegreenwoodproject.com.
Mm-hmm.
It'll link you to his Schedule C, which is his investment. It's like his investment memorandum that he had to submit to the SEC to get approved.
But is it a business plan?
He's giving an outline of what he wants to do. He wants to create an incubator to incubate other little businesses and then put those businesses on the platform, have them packaged and structured and put them on the platform to raise money. He wants to be a channel of venture capital for African Americans. Mm-hmm. African Americans currently have access to about, used about 1% of the venture capital that's been funded. But we have a lot of young minds and a lot of minds that have had more access to venture capital that could create the Googles and Apples of the world too. So that's his plan with the $1 million, to create an incubator, incubate seed some other things that will go on the platform to raise money for them.
Mm-hmm. So Mr.
And
Brown,
and to have people on his team that know how to vet those deals, to put deals out that they think are reasonable.
Okay, so Mr. Brown, does this or gentleman or group have experienced advisors around them? Because that's what the key is. Or you're not going to really attract anyone if there are no experienced advisors where people feel comfortable. Like, I wouldn't feel comfortable just putting my money with somebody brand new. And I do it, you know, we've invested in mutual funds, money market accounts. In fact, in the 2008 crash, we lost a lot of our money from money market.
But you invest in those for different reasons. Those are stable.
Right.
Some are safe, some are stable. When you're making a speculative investment, you know, that's when we talk $100. Mm-hmm. We're not talking about any. I don't consider $100 real money. Mm-hmm. I consider $100 throwaway money. But yes, I'm an advisor to him. He's building his crew as he's raising his money. So if you went on his site, you see I'm on the executive board, and I've got, you know, I funded over 100 deals, you know, and I have a big percentage of successes. So yes, he wants that talent to help guide him through the process. But what he is he's a sculpture being sculpted. He's a young man with a bright idea that has surrounded himself with three of his cohorts from school, and that is building his team to carry the vision as he requests the money to do it. So if it's a shoe that don't fit, people shouldn't do it. So the idea here is pure metrics. If we can reach 15 million families, there ought to be 10,000 people willing to write a check just because he's trying to do it. And the others don't. It's that simple. It is that simple. Because there's really nothing to really to research a vet. He has an idea. He's asking people to take a risk. And it's something that either they emotionally do. This isn't a vetted, planned, structured, I believe in this. This is emotional, a good thing to do. You know, and if you feel that way, you do it. And if you don't feel that way, you don't do it.
But people aren't. Okay, so here's what myself and Jewel and what the hosts are saying is that there's not a bio. I went to the website. I did not see a viable plan. I didn't, all the stuff that you're saying, I didn't see that. And so maybe I didn't go to the right spot. I went to where the mission was, but I didn't.
No. There's a link. Like, it'll link you to the EDGAR site for the SEC where
okay. His
documents are on file.
Okay.
And it isn't a business plan. It's not what you see as a formal business plan. It is what you would see in a private placement memorandum, but it isn't as structured as what I do in a private placement memorandum when I'm doing something that has less risk. You can't take risk out of this one. He's 22 years old. How much can he write about how he's going to do what he's going to do, and he's never done it?
True.
He's not going to be there. So what you're saying is, like, for you and most of your listeners, it don't fit. But isn't that true? If there's 15 million African-American families and he's looking for 10,000, I mean, 1% would be 150,000. So 10,000, 15,000 would be 1/10 of 1%. So he's looking for less than that 1/10 of 1%. That like his idea and are willing to support it. That's all he's looking for.
Okay,
so,
Mel.
So we don't care if he gets 99 no's. We're looking for the one yes. We're looking for the needles in the haystack.
Okay, but this show is specifically about Black economics, not specifically promoting the Greenwood Project. So we just wanted you to say a few things about that.
Let's revert back to Black economics. Our Black Economic Index say we're 95 point 94.8% below par. And the way we're going to get on par is us learning to, in addition to buying from ourselves, is invest in ourselves. So, you know, I mean, that is the message for the evening. Mm-hmm. An example of investing in a speculative investment is Greenwood. But, you know, there are things that we can suggest that are stable. There are things we can suggest that are safe. But the whole consciousness I'm trying to raise is a consciousness that we've got to invest in ourselves. I'm not selling Greenwood. I'm announcing Greenwood. And that's it, period. So there are others that could be announced. This week is Greenwood that's being announced. So on the economic front, what I'm talking about is in economics, we lag by almost 95% in being on par. And if we don't get on par in this democracy, we'll never have power. Our power in this democracy is based off capital formation, period. It's not based off the vote. The vote elects politicians. The politicians are led by industry. So if we don't, we'll never have integration. If we're not economically integrated, we can be civically integrated, we can be socially integrated, live anywhere we want, stop anywhere we want, travel anywhere we want, but we won't get the equity in politics or the equity in justice if we're not economically integrated. So where we are now, and I guess the point of wanting to be on is not to just advertise Greenwood. Mm-hmm. The point of being on is to introduce the Abaco Black Economic Index. Mm-hmm. The Black Economic Index each year will measure where we are and where we will prove, and it's really to encourage our people to invest in ourselves.
Okay, there's another question because we've only got a few more minutes. So, Mel, or who, somebody.
I just had a question in terms of other communities. Do they use this tool in other communities like the Hispanic community or the Asian community when they invest in themselves? Is this the formula that is similar to something they do? Or?
Yes. Both of those the Asian community index exceeds par, and the Hispanic index, you know, if you look at each of those numbers we're talking about, it exceeds Black America.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. We lag if you compare the norm, Asians, Hispanics, Blacks, we're coming in last.
And which would be our greatest deficit, if you will, in terms of doing something like this? Would it be trust, or would it be understanding the process?
It would be a mindset of trust. It's a mindset change. Learning to invest in our own. And then is what the host was speaking of. We've got to learn how to, what due diligence to do, and we got to understand a portfolio. And we got to understand our risk profile. We got to understand what are the safe items, what are the stable items, and what are the speculative items. And we got to understand what percentage we should have in each category. See, like, we would never want anyone to have more than 5 to 10% at most in the speculative category. And we want to have them to have most in the stable category. And then they ought to be stuff in the safe category. And then some things should be income producing, and other things should be for appreciation. That's the information that has to be absorbed and understood. And then people can make choices.
Right. And Julie, do you have a last question?
Yes. Do you know of any, is there anywhere where Black people can go? You know, we got Standard & Poor's, we got the Dow Jones, the Nikkei. Is there a listing of publicly traded African American owned businesses that are publicly traded?
Yes.
Where would one find that?
For instance, Radio One is a publicly traded entity. It capitalized at 90 to 120 million, depending on what you're talking about. Bob Johnson has a real estate investment trust out there that trades at less than $2 a share, that pays out 95% of his income. We have two banks that are publicly traded, you know. Most of these would fall into the stable, but the banks aren't performing well, so they might go into a risk category. Those are the best reason Abaco has been created, what I'm building now. You know, we want to share with our people this economic, this investment index, but we want to share with them all the investment opportunities that are available, not just Greenwood. So we like to encourage your listeners to go to abaco-llc.com and just register. And then they'll be in our database. And as we begin to put out information and events, they will have access to this investment matrix. They'll have access to opportunities that are speculative, opportunities that are safe, opportunities that are stable. Some of them we will be representing, and some of them we will, you'll have to go to your broker, or we will be directing you to who represents them.
Okay.
Thank you very much. So this was very informative. Any final thought? Any final thoughts that you would like to say, Mr. Brown, in regards to Black economics and any of the trust and things that we need to work on as a community?
No, I just like people to, you know, the index is available, so we'll be sending it out. If you register on my site, you can get a copy of an A paper talking about the index and the things we talked about tonight. And it'll give you some other reading material. It'll give you a bunch of websites to go to see what else is happening, and some other stuff on black economics. It will give you a reading list you can read, and it will teach you how you can plan where you are on your journey in life with your financial infrastructure. The stuff we don't see that you need to have in place, your retirement, your budget, your credit rating, your portfolio. You know, so we want to be a resource to all of our people to help them grow.
Can he spell the website so we get it real clear?
Mr. Brown, can you please spell that website so we can get that clear? We couldn't quite get the name of that.
A-B-A-C-O.
A-B-A-C-O.
Okay.
Okay.
So like tuna.
Dash. L-L-C.
L-L-C.
.com.
Okay, good. So that way people can go back and refer to this video. And we'd like to thank Mr. John Brown, who is of the Bedford Group, who came in. You know, he at least explained to us the stuff that we need to be.
Oh, yeah. And I'm looking forward to going to the resource.
And we need to do that when we're talking about risk, what's stable, and understanding that we have to take risk, you know?
Yeah.
So we appreciate you, Mr. Brown, coming on the show. And we certainly would like to have you back. And we look forward to talking to you more about economics and going to the next step, people that want to start delving into investing and see what they can do.
Thank you for having me, and you guys keep up the good work up there in Fresno.
Thank you so much. Thank you. Folks, thank you. Those of you watching, we are going to be back. We're going to have a short break. We're going to be coming back with Marshawn Govan. Remember we talked about being insured, and remember we talked about taxes and getting our stuff together, we have to stop talking about it and acting about it. So we're going to have our next financial expert as we are really discussing the state of Black economics here in the Central Valley. So you can call in. I know no one really called in on that one. Probably you were listening. I get it. We will be right back.
My teachers and principal work really hard to keep my school safe so I can spend time on my favorite subjects.
But sometimes emergencies happen, and our schools have to take action to ensure our safety, including notifying parents. Make sure your emergency contact information is current with the school office. Fresno Unified is launching Rapid Alert, a new emergency text notification system in the event there is a safety issue at our schools.
When you receive the Rapid Alert text, please opt in so that we can continue to be safe.
Attention, are you stuck in student loan debt? If you owe $10,000 or more in federal student loans and are having trouble making your payments, call now to see if you are eligible for a reduction in your student loan payments. Living under the pressure of student loan repayment can feel like drowning sometimes. You may even be late or in default on your loans. Give us a call now for a special free offer. The call is free and the information is free, and there is no obligation. Imagine living a life unburdened by student loan debt.
This future may be only one free call away. Student loan debt relief can help stop tax garnishments and release cosigners. We've helped many people struggling with their student loan payments. Call us now to see if we can help you get on the path to a student loan debt-free future. Call 800-946-8578. That's 800-946-8578.
Did you know that having health insurance is the law? If you can afford health insurance but chose not to get it for 2016, you may be required to pay a fee, sometimes called the penalty, fine, or individual mandate when you file your 2016 federal income taxes. The good news is ICANN Benefit can help you save on health insurance and get you covered the same day for the future. For 2016, the fee is $695 or 2.5% of your income, whichever is higher. For many people, that's more than the yearly cost of our health plans. For tax year 2017 and beyond, the percentage option will remain at 2.5%, but the flat fee will be adjusted for inflation. This could end up costing you hundreds or even thousands of dollars every year, and that doesn't even account for any medical services you may require. Call ICANN now. Health insurance is the law.
Call 800-650-2779. That's 800-650-2779.
U.S. Med has great news for anyone living with diabetes.
If you have Medicare, private insurance, or prescription drug coverage, U.S. Med will ship a new glucose meter right to your home.
And shipping is free.
My new meter uses only a speck of blood, so it's less painful than my previous meter.
If you have Medicare, private insurance, or prescription drug coverage, you're covered with U.S. Med. We're welcoming new patients, even if your current provider can't supply you anymore.
I don't even have to test on my fingers anymore. I can test on my hand or forearms, and it's more accurate than my old meter.
So call U.S. Med today, and you'll have a choice of two great meters.
One that actually speaks your results. Or a meter that takes less blood and can even Bluetooth to your phone.
Act now, and U.S. Med will include a free prescription discount card. We'll also send you a free diabetes cookbook. This is your opportunity.
So call U.S. Med today.
You'll be glad you did.
If you owe $10,000 or more to the IRS or state, this may be the most important phone call you'll ever make.
I owed $87,000 in taxes. But listen.
Your tax problem is settled. You only owe $3,500.
What a great message.
If you owe $10,000 or more to the IRS or state, then you owe it to yourself to call this number. Let our experts help guide you through the process of negotiating a tax settlement. Call this number or go to tax10000.com.
Snacking has never been this exciting. At Graze.com, we combine wholesome ingredients with the flavors we all love to create over 100 exciting snacks, like these. We'd love to send you a Graze sampler box for free. Just go to Graze.com, enter the code ENJOY12, and we'll mail your free box to your home or office. Join thousands of Grazers already in love with our exciting snacks. So come to Graze.com for your first box free.
Attention Medicare patients, this is an important message from Medical Supply Helpline.
If you struggle with back or knee pain, you could receive a brace at little or no cost. Medical Supply Helpline connects you with a knowledgeable customer service representative that's available right now. The call is free, there's no paperwork to sign, and Medicare is billed directly. Call us today.
To learn more, call Medical Supply Helpline at 800-533-1394.
This is an important medical message from the Pain Management Network. Do you suffer from severe back or knee pain, making even your most simple everyday activities difficult? Well, if you're on Medicare, we have great news. You can now receive a pain-relieving knee or back brace at little or no cost to you. We'll handle the paperwork with Medicare for free. All shipping and customer service is free. And the call to check your eligibility is free.
Call now at 800-235-2801, 800-235-2801.
Technology has been around for a while, and it's important, you know, as you see things happen across the nation, that we do everything we can to ensure the safety of all of our students. So as it's come up, we wanted to make sure we were doing it and doing it well, that we have the opportunity to communicate it in a way that as many parents would have the opportunity to opt in. You know, as with our EduTech system, which we have for school attendance and grade data, There are 70,000 students. We have 20,000 people signed up for that. We believe that this is one that we really want people to sign up for because we want people to have safety information in live time. Nothing particular, you know, precipitated us doing it other than it doesn't take a lot of searching to recognize that these incidents occur, and we want to be proactive in making sure that nothing occurs in front of you that we're not adequately prepared to respond to. If that situation on a school campus was something that necessitated either the student's school being dismissed or something that interrupted the total flow of school, that would be something that we'd send an edutext for. If it were something that was but that site leaders had responded to and that situation was contained, it's potential that we would not necessarily do that, which is not to say we would not communicate it. We would communicate it by other means. This is really about urgent situations in live time that require a response. If a parent feels like the school might not have their accurate data, you could go in right away, talk to the school office manager or the student attendance person at the front office and say, I need to fill out an alternative emergency card and give them their newest contact information. If there's a card on file, they'll simply make those modifications and make those changes in the system. Or if there's not a card on file, we need to have that card on file right away. It's not unusual for parents to have cell phone plans that may go off in periods of time. Some people have temporary phone plans. If that's the circumstance, it's really crucial that as the new phone number comes online, that it's given to the school site, and then that's reflected in our student database. But this specific system here is really about responding to things in live time so that we can tell parents where they need to go or what would be the best thing to do so that they know how to move in a situation that requires urgency. In fact, some of the sample messages that you see dictate some of the things that they would need to do in that regard. If, for example, the school is being closed early, for example, in the case of a gas leak, it would say, we would ask you to come and pick up your student as soon as possible. And it would give them directions that there was a place to do that. For example, let's say the students were dismissed to the backside of the campus as with a fire situation and they're deployed to the backside of the campus. The rapid alert message would, you know, it's only 160 characters, but we would give as much specificity as we could, telling the parents where they would need to arrive and how to go about picking up their child. That's the goal. If the emergency card has multiple numbers and those multiple numbers are in the system, then those multiple numbers would be put into the rapid alert system and those people would be contacted as well. You want that level of duplicity. You know, some people have, there's any number of different reasons. You might have other people in your card that you want to have know about what's happening with your child. Again, our intentionality here is to make this as broadly understood as it can be, to communicate to as many involved families, guardians, and community members as we can. I need to reiterate again, it's crucially important that the school have your correct information on file, and that as that information changes, you need to change it with us in live time. Before, normally we would use that phone messenger system. The problem with phone messenger in terms of its being immediate, I can give you a scenario that we had where there was a power outage, so we used the phone messenger system. That could go out in English immediately, but for it to go out in Spanish and Hmong simultaneously, it requires translation. So we had a situation, if that took 30 minutes for that message to be translated and dismissed, that power may be back on by the end of that time frame. So the advantage of this, because it's only 160 characters, it's immediately translated into both Spanish and Hmong and distributed. I can't speak to other schools that are using this, but I know that this type of technology is used across the state. If you know Fresno State, for example, has the Bulldog Alert System, which is not unlike what we're talking about here with Fresno Unified's Rapid Alert System.
Much excitement that happens on the break. You just wouldn't know.
When you talk about money, it's exciting.
When you talk to experts in financial services about money, it's exciting. Yeah. And so, welcome back to Valley Black Talk Radio. We're at our State of Black Central Valley Economics Part 1, and we will be having that Part 2 on Sunday. But we cannot, I mean, we have to give you all of the information, folks. So we are so delighted, and we are so excited to be able to have Marshawn Govan, who's here, MKG Insurance, and he's licensed, knows every aspect when we're talking about finance, insurance, everything, and where we need to do and start getting our money right. And that's from the average individual to even the business owner. So we want to say welcome, Marshawn Govan, to Valley Black Talk Radio as we talk about the state of Black Central Valley economics.
Mm-hmm. Yep, thank you for inviting me to the show, and we're here to have an open discussion on economics or the state of the Black economics here.
And from your perspective, because you're in this industry, from you're handling taxes, you can handle from every aspect when you're looking at the finances of African Americans in general, or even your clients. What are some of the commonalities, or what are some of the key issues that you see when it comes to people's finances?
Well, we don't really have a plan. People don't really have a financial need analysis. It's like when you go to the doctor and you
wait. Explain all that, because people are like, wait, financial needs? Well, what would I need that for?
It's like when you go to the doctor and you get a checkup. You know, the doctor's going to check your height. You know, they're going to check your blood pressure. They're going to check your temperature. Well, your finances aren't no different. You know, you're going to, you know, check and see, you know, how much you're bringing in every month. You know, looking at all your bills, all your expenses, because most people have no idea of how much money they're spending, let alone how much money they're making. And then when you match the two up, then you're able to understand, am I making not enough? Of course we're not, because we're always in the struggle.
Right.
But then it also helps you understand on how to balance that. And that's what a financial need analysis is.
It sounds like to me you're trying to take all the fun out of life. You want every dollar to be accounted for.
It's a little personal invasion, but you know, you have to come out of that comfort zone and be able to be comfortable. Like when you go with your doctor, when the doctor says take off your shirt and put on this robe, are you going to feel uncomfortable? But you know that you're with a professional, and you know it's not going to be anything to, you know, make you
detrimental
feel
to you.
Detrimental, make you feel uncomfortable, or make you feel like, well, you know, he's doing this to either sexually or physically exploit me. The same way with your finances. You know, we're not here to probe, and you know, we're not going to kind of, you know, rob you or kind of take anything from you, but we're just going to give you that understanding of that picture. You don't know, like when you go grocery shopping, most people don't know, you know, everything on the inside of the grocery store is stuff that you might not need, which is all your junk, all your cookies, all your Zoom Zooms. But everything on the outside, like your milk, your meat, your potatoes, all that's on the outside.
That's true.
And so that's the same way with your finances. You know, there's the outside of your finances and there's the inside of your finances. And until you really understand and see the way those two you know, work hand in hand, then that's how you're able to get on track. And when you're talking about, you know, economics, you know, that is the foundation of economics, is to, you know where your money's going.
Excuse me. And Mr. Engineer, can you hear him? Because he got some good stuff going in, but he got a real soft voice.
I want to make sure. Okay.
Make sure when we play this back, we hear everything you say.
Because people are going to be rewind. They're going to keep going back and back and back. So how do you get people out of that fear of wanting to get the finances checked? Because usually we'll only get a finances check if we're in trouble or tax trouble.
Especially black people. Am I being too specific?
You know, it's really not based on any particular demographics. You know, anybody is prone to, you know, financial troubles, whether you're African American, Hispanic, Latino, white, Asian. It's nobody's pretty much invincible. You know, it's...
Yeah, we know it happened to everybody.
Yeah.
We're a little bit more to the vest with ours than most other folks in terms of reaching out.
We don't want people to know.
Well, most people don't like to ask for help. Mm-hmm. And, you know, coming to somebody that is, you know, have a little bit more insight, you know, it's just that help. I mean, I don't know what I know until I go to other people to get that, you know, expertise and advice. So just like me, you know, if I'm not going to tell you to go buy a car, you know, that I don't own and I don't drive, I got to be a product of the product. And so I also go, it's like counseling. If you don't want to go and get that, you know, seek that help or advice, you can't better your situation. And it's all about self-help first, and then understanding, you know, about your finances. And finances, when we talk about finances, it's like a branch to a tree. It goes in so many different directions. It just depends on what you want to prune back and what you want to leave on the branch or on the vine.
That's key. I like that. His analogies are great.
You get double the fruit next time around.
Exactly. Do you want to?
Yeah, you got a whole bunch of limbs that are stealing the nutrients and vitamins that you won't need. You're better off pruning it back so you can have just what you need to grow.
And there, you know,
grapes.
Exactly.
You know what I'm about that. See,
I'm not that country. I'm not that country. But
you forget,
you know,
I'm a country girl.
I call it plant those seeds, you know, to harvest. You know, there's slow. A slow accumulation, and then most people want that fast accumulation.
Right.
With the fast accumulation, there is risk, but then there's also control of the risk. It depends on what market, you know, people are wanting to go. But, you know, right now it depends on what your age is and what part of your life are you really, you know, looking at your future.
Yeah, that's true.
Are you looking to plan for college, pay for your kids' education, or do you want to, you know, live for the moment now and then worry about having to take out all these student loans and incur all this debt, mm-hmm. where in 10 years with the right plan, all that can be paid for. And, you know, there's kind of two rules, you know, I like to follow Albert Einstein, mm-hmm. because he came up with a rule called Rule 72, mm-hmm. which is compound interest. Mm-hmm. What that does is take your principal and your interest and you divide it, and it tells you how many years it takes to double. Mm-hmm. And it's just like what the banks and everybody else use when you buy a home and a mortgage. You know, that's how, if you buy a home, you know, your home might only be a couple of hundred, but when you get done paying for it, you pay so much in interest. Well, you can use that as an investment tool, too, and that's another way you can leverage economics. Hmm. Then there's another rule called 108, which is your retirement, you know, working for some, you know, company for 30 years, and then, you know, you having that money put away, you know, pre-taxed or tax-deferred, but then you're taxing it when you pull it out.
That's Jules. She's excited about that.
That's my burning question.
And right now, the way, you know, things are in the Social Security, you know, it, you know, that's one of those taboo things that we don't really hear about from, you know, our parents, don't really hear about, you know, from people that we hang around with our friends, because it's kind of invisible. We don't mm-hmm. see it. Mm-hmm. We choose not to see it, even though it's there, it's present, it's around us. But it's just nobody's tapping on our shoulders telling us, hey, wake up, you know, take a look at this until, you know, you get old and you retire. And mm-hmm. then you really find out this is not enough for me to support myself, mm-hmm. let alone if anything happens between that time, you know, like if your loved one or spouse gets sick. That's why we sell insurance, you mm-hmm. know, that has, you know, things that are built in place for people that they can, you know, if they get cancer, mm-hmm. you know. Mm-hmm. Sure, your health insurance is going to cover you to
right,
a point,
right.
but, you know, what's going to happen, you know, when you die?
I mean, your family. And
yeah, your family, you know, you want that house paid for. Mm-hmm. I mean, you know, we don't really prepare for the future. Mm-hmm. We don't prepare for those shortcomings.
Mm-hmm. Julie, did that answer your burning question? Do you want to
no.
add it?
So I've opened a Roth. I've funded it, but I haven't purchased anything yet. But in preparing to open the Roth, of course, I was reading about Roth and I was reading about 403Bs. I had a 403B. I still have, but I'm getting ready to shove that into the Roth because mm-hmm. There's something about, and my mom always says, you don't put and take. You know, if you're saving, you put and you leave it there. But there's something about putting my money somewhere, and then if I need it, I go say, give me my money, and they say, oh, no, you can't have it for anything. So, which is why I'm transferring the funds that are in my 403B mm-hmm. to the Roth.
And what is a Roth, may I ask?
Well, okay, I'll come back to that, but my question is, and I know it's different for every person, it depends on your circumstances, but do you personally have a preference for Roth, which means your taxes won't be taken out until you... I mean, which means your taxes, right, won't be taken out until you go to withdraw the money, mm-hmm. or do you prefer something like a 403B where it's taken out then,
pre-tax.
So you don't have it pre-tax, so you don't have it taken out at 65 when you're trying to, you know, draw your
well, you know,
your benefits.
That's a touchy subject because right now the Department of Labor has ruled down on full 401ks and, you know, all that, you know, as far as investment advice and stuff. And it changed the industry so much. You know, they fined Merrill Lynch, LPL Financial. I mean, those kind of things are really, you know, you have to really give that sound advice. I mean, like you said, you know, do you want to put your money in something that has to stay in for so long, because, you know, there's penalties where if you take it out before you reach 59 and a half, you
pay can't
10%.
Take it out. That's the thing.
You can certain circumstances.
Emergencies. With a 401k, not with a 403k.
Yes, you can.
There is rules
yes,
that
you
allow
can.
You to, if you're going to be purchasing a home, mm-hmm. going to college. Yep. I mean, there is ways that
there
you
are
can
some
borrow,
caveats.
But then you have to pay it back
illness.
At a certain interest rate, mm-hmm. illnesses. You know, it all depends on your suitability.
Because we have a 403b, that's why.
When I say suitability.
Well, when I asked about 3 months ago,
they don't want you to take anything out.
Yeah, and they said the law has changed and you can't take money out the way you used to.
You can take it out.
So
you can take it out. I mean, you have an option to cash it out, but if you cash it out, you're going to take the 10% penalty. Mm-hmm. You're also going to have to pay the federal estate tax.
I'm hiring you because I need you to talk to them and tell them, give this crazy woman her money, because they said no.
You can always do.
I can move it into the Roth.
It's called a like-kind exchange. Mm-hmm. So if you have a 403B and you're moving it over into another like-kind of
vehicle, the Roth is different though. That's what
so
they told me.
So it's treated as a different tax deferred. You know, some companies have the 403B, which is like your tax shelters. Then some companies have the 401K. A lot of companies have, you know, did away with the 401Ks because of the, depending on the way it's invested into the market, because it is, you know, tied to the S&P, the NASDAQ, Dow Jones. And so it suffers, you know, the market losses. And a lot of people lost a lot of money, you know, during the
2008,
the foreclosure and stuff. So, you know, I really don't kind of sell that at all. I actually sell fixed annuities. And what that is basically you're protected from the downside of the market. Only thing you can gain is from the upside. So if the market
is an investment, how can you only gain from upside?
Because, you know, the insurance companies are taking a risk. Your money is going to be, like I said, your money stays level. So if the market goes and they go 20 points below the market, you don't have to worry about that because you're still going to have the same amount of money that you have from the day one of year one to the, whenever the market went down, even to the end of the year, versus in the 401k, you're going to see, you know, those negatives, you know, against your money that you're investing in. So it's a little different. I don't believe in putting all my eggs in one basket. And it's something, you know, it's not nothing new. It's something that's been around for a long time. And if you structure it right and you do a you know, right financial plan, you know, you can benefit from it. Some of those are 6 years, 8 years, 10 years. Some of them give you 10%.
So they appreciate, and then you can do whatever with your money. It's not locked in for,
It's not locked in. Some, but, you know, that's why we have to do the suitability, because if all your assets are in there, some, it's just now the way the industry and the rules and laws have changed. You know, I'm not going to get paid from you. I get paid from the insurance companies who I represent. There's a few out there, you know, AIG, they have some, but it also depends on your age. You know, would a 401k be good for somebody?
I'm not going to say anything about AIG.
Somebody's turning, you know, 70 years old. No, that's not a good 401k wouldn't be any good for them because they're going to be required to take that distribution. Some people get to a point where they don't want to take their money out. They just want to leave it where it's at. So therefore, maybe a Roth might be good for them because it gives you an extra, you know, 10 years or so, 70 and a half versus 59 and a half. Do you need to, depending on what point in time do you need to take your money out, or do you want to still go golfing, or do you want to never have to have a create a lifetime income? That's where an annuity might come in and it might be better suited for you because, you know, you get a little bit every month, or do you want to just kind of wait to a certain point, then start receiving it where now the taxation on it is lesser than you would taking the withdrawals, you know, either the early withdrawal or until you reach your retirement age.
Before you guys ask this question, I just want to let folks know you're watching Valley Black Talk Radio, State of Black Central Valley. We are discussing economics part one, and we are with our financial expert, Marshawn Govan, MKG Insurance, giving us valuable information. You're going to have to rewind or go back to the beginning of this when we start at the 7 o'clock hour when he started discussing this, because all the information is very important and pertinent to getting our finances straight. The number to call in or text in is 559-365-6233. Mel, you look like you were about to ask a question.
No, I'm just, this is so good in terms of what you're sharing and how germane it is. I got some questions, but after we flow past this, maybe after the break, we go.
No, we got it. We're not going to break. We're going straight through.
You better ask. We're on your own because I got something that will take you in a completely different direction.
Well, I just have a question.
As it relates to
insurance. Getting people comfortable with a financial expert such as yourself, and this is probably just a, I don't know, emotional question. Do you all judge a person off of where they are, their finances? I'm just asking.
No, it's good. Like, do they look at the portfolio
you're
and
like,
go,
oh, this is terrible. Oh, my God. Do you guys do that?
You
have to ask that, you know?
It's like when you go into the gym.
Okay.
You know, when you go to the gym, you might not have been to the gym for a few years or a few months. You know, we got to work people's finances out and get them back in shape. You know, so of course we're going to have people come in that bent out of shape. I, you know, sometimes get bent out of shape, but it's like exercise. You get better and you improve on it. And, you know, each session, each, you know, checkup, you know.
See, that ain't what she
I'm asking, do you judge them and say, this is terrible. Oh, my God. Look at her taxes.
We don't judge people on by a book or by their finances because you never know. That person can end up, you know, being the next Warren Buffett because, you know, It's all about the education. Mm-hmm. Once the education is there, once the information is there, once the plan and the strategy's in place, you know, they can turn their situations around. Anybody can turn it around. But okay. if they choose not to follow the plan and they come back and they're in that same place that, you know, we discussed, you know, from a year ago, mm-hmm. then pretty much then it's like, well, I thought we talked about this. Yeah, I told you this, you know. Yeah. But then they're feeling, it's not for me to judge. They're going to feel embarrassed saying that I didn't take your advice and I knew you were right. And, you know, and it was sound advice.
Right.
So if you don't take sound advice and, you know, it's pretty
much. That's when it's on you. Yeah. Then you should feel embarrassed.
Now, I'm wondering, do you find that clients are over 40 or under 40? And I ask because, you know, as long as you get a little government job, you can get your hair and your nails did. You know, you don't, I'm going to just speak for me. I'm always, you know, I know I should save. Mm-hmm. But you got the car note, the house note, you know, all this stuff. But now, at 50 plus, I am really focused on retirement. And I'm doing, putting things in place now, which...
You're 50?
We'll talk about.
Remember we celebrated her 50th just this year?
No.
I was giving you okay, 2 years ago. I was giving
you. Now, why you just tell everybody that?
You did. That's your age.
I know, I just went up. But at like 48, 49, 50, I started thinking, well, okay, wait. And then you, every so often you get those letters from Social Security that says, we ain't giving you no money till you get 80. Wow. Mine is actually 67. Uh-huh. But... now I'm thinking about retirement, and I've got the Roth, and I've got some other things that I need to work out. So my question is just, do you find that people tend to think about retirement and saving and planning more as they age, or are you finding that even college students are thinking, I want to work out my finances now so that I'm not 60 still paying on my college bill, like you said?
You know, that's a tough question. I think it comes down to the family values, you know, how their, you know, parents, father, you know, what they instilled in them, you know, was it to, you know, work hard, save, or,
yeah, they
you know, or it was just, you know, don't just whatever they did, they was nobody to say, hey, give them a rebuttal. You shouldn't have been
tomorrow
doing this.
Tomorrow is not promised to you.
But, you know, you're right. Tomorrow isn't promised, but at the same time, it always is that when you get older, then you start getting wiser and you start thinking about, you know, your future, your golden years, I would say. You know, and you keep referring back to the 401k or the 403b, you know, that's like a comfort zone because, you know, everybody say, you know, do it this way. And mm-hmm. but that's not the only way. But you also have to think about health. You know, does it give you that protection if you get sick, if you go to the doctor, if you get cancer? You know, do you have any critical or, you know, any of those in riders that, mm-hmm. you know, will start coming into play where you can cash out and not be penalized? So that's where their annuity plan, or there also is asset protection plan, where if you, you know, match, you're getting matched 3-1. So if you put in 100, you're getting 300 in long-term care. So long-term care is things that people are not thinking about, you know.
Whatever my employer plan is, and I know folks who have retired and say, now that I have to pay for it, it's ridiculously expensive. Mm-hmm. But of course, I'm counting on my insurer, my employer plan. Even after you retire, but of course it changes and you start paying the. So
because it's not.
Are you talking about instruments where I would have an addition?
Correct. Or when you say instruments, so let's say for example, your 401k plan does not have like a rider in it to where if you got.
Well, I don't want 401k.
Yeah, but 403b. Some of those, mm-hmm, if you're still employed by the employer, then you know you have your accidental coverages. You have your critical illness plans if you know opt into that during their elections. But at the same time, when you leave that company, that plan belongs to the company.
Right.
You know, it's not considered portable. You know, and of course, it's like if you had health insurance, you got on Cobra, it becomes too expensive.
Yeah, but that's what I'm saying.
But
like
when
a,
you buy the plan that we give you, you own that plan. You know, you're
that's
pretty
the
much
difference.
That's the difference. And at the same time,
and you can take it anywhere.
You own it, so it doesn't matter. It's vested with this one company, and you can have it, heirs can inherit it, or you're the, you know, owner, and you can name who you want as the beneficiary.
Oh, okay. So, just to be clear, you're not talking about an insurance plan. You're talking about money in the bank, so to speak, that you can use.
I'm talking about an annuity.
Annuity.
Oh, annuity.
Annuity.
Okay.
An annuity or even a life insurance plan where either it's going to be a whole life or index universal life or an annuity. sometimes it's a combination of both, you know, because one does one that another can't do, because you can't just stuff, you know, a whole, if you was to take your whole 403B, you couldn't just put it into a life insurance plan. It takes 5 years to vest it. So you have to have a vehicle to hold that money, which would be an annuity that would end up, you know, funding that life insurance policy. So it'd be paid up in 5 years. And lo and behold, in 5 years, you let it grow for 10 years, you have $1 million or $2 million death benefit. And then you also have a tax-free portion of it that you don't have to worry about. So it gives you a blend of two. It's like a cocktail, you know. It's a different kind of an instrument now that, you know, most people that are used to one thing and they're not knowing about what's out there new now. It's like the electric cars, you know.
He's got good similes and metaphors, huh?
Yeah. I'm telling you, I'm sorry, folks, but he's here, so I'm going to get all my stuff worked out.
Yeah, I mean.
Okay, so in addition to
you're going
to
have to do this on the side. We talk about black economics. Let's move on.
Can benefit from this.
Ask him during the break.
I mean, that's how you empower yourself or you plan for
She's trying to get counseling while we're live on Valley Black Talk Radio.
Well, other people might benefit. I'm going to ask you
how
on
about,
the break.
How about this? Can you give people your information so that they can... I mean, they could technically, you're licensed, so they can go through you to find out more information, be actually
correct.
Purchase the annuity or insurance and all that stuff, right?
I think what, you know, we're underserved or at least we're undereducated on is, you know, the annuities on the life insurance, mm-hmm. how we can use it, even the college planning.
Yes, we are.
Some of the businesses, too, you know, you have the buy-sell agreements, you have the, you know, succession plans, mm-hmm. estate planning. And then you have the annuities for your retirement, you know, then there's even the long-term care. You know, mm-hmm. we don't even think about who's going to take care of us.
No, we don't.
We can't take care of ourselves.
Wow.
You know, there's companies out there that, you know, been around for a long time. They offer some good products. And, you know, every agent, you know, they don't like to discuss that or they mm-hmm, don't mm-hmm. want to go. They only want to just sell one particular product. Mm-hmm. But I'm looking at the whole table. Mm-hmm. I do about 10 different things, and I look at 10 different, you know, products for the, you know, person, and ask them what they want to do. I mean, they might not have the money to afford, you know, those plans now. So we'll start them off on like a term.
Mm-hmm.
You know, the term will give them, you know, that temporary coverages. It also give them their, you know, critical chronic illnesses, and so, you know, they don't have to be, you know, worried, and they own that. So, mm-hmm. you know, that's just a start. And then in a year time from now, or they graduate from college, then they can go ahead and convert it to something different. You know, it's like a trade-in. You trade
right.
in your car for something, you upgrade. Just
right.
We'll upgrade them to something different.
Okay.
But, you know, we'll start them off with what they can afford.
And so they should start now. Even if it's, I mean, what would be the minimum budget a person would need just to get started?
You know, it depends. You know, normally the minimum value is about 100,
okay.
you know, 100,000.
Okay.
And the younger you get it, the cheaper it is.
There
because
you go.
The risk,
there
the
you
risk
go.
And, you know, is not as bad now, mm. depending on how their health is. Are they smoking cigarettes?
Mm.
You know, they have, you know, pre-existing medical conditions, mm-hmm. you know, their blood, how are they, if they have diabetes, are their cholesterol out of whack? I mean, you know, so nowadays it's different. You know, when you buy insurance or you get a plan, you know, it's like going to the doctor. It's the same scenario. They're going to do blood draws. They're going to do your height, your weight, your family medical history, your, you know, medical reports, mm-hmm. you know, all that stuff plays a factor, you know, because now it's the risk factor. It's all mm-hmm. about risks.
People are scared of that. How do you draw them in to be able to, especially African Americans, we don't like to go to the doctor.
Well,
I can't get my dad to a doctor. He got in an accident and walked out and would not go to the doctor, was afraid to go to the hospital.
You know, it's
he
was
still
hurt,
cute.
But he wouldn't go. So how do you do that? How do you get them past that point?
I mean, you know, all you can do is give them that information, education. Some people take it home, some people don't. And some people, you know, take it with a grain of salt. Yeah, I mean, exactly. You know, and when those car wash time come or, mm-hmm. you know, when those tragedies come, I mean, a lot of poverty is contributed to either medical expenses
mm-hmm.
or unemployment. You know, there's triggers that, you know, if you're hurt on your job, you know, are you going to wait on unemployment, mm-hmm. disability, or are you going to kind of invest in yourself and say, well, now I've kind of invested and prepared for something like this, and, you know, I'm covered for a couple of years mm-hmm. now, and, you know, depending on how severe it is and if you can be rehabilitated from that, mm-hmm. you know, it's just depending on the situation.
Mm-hmm. Mel?
Yeah, I got it. Since you did kind of touch on it there when you talk about life insurance, Do you sell policies to groups, in other words, associations that would want to insure their membership or something like that?
Yeah, I mean, you know, we sell group plans. We do everything. I mean, we have quotes come from the federal government. They're, you know, wanting us to give their whole county, you know, employees. Mm. Of course, we're all competing and bidding against it. Mm-hmm. So, you know, we've done anywhere from 12,000 people quotes to one person. Mm-hmm. So it's any number, you know, any size, you know.
Let me tell you why I'm asking that. And you mentioned earlier about the car washes and folks that didn't have insurance out trying to make sure they can bury their loved ones. If you're a member of an association such as an NAACP.
That's what I was thinking.
And part of your membership would be included in you being eligible or being covered by an insurance plan that would be part of the
membership perks.
Yeah.
And
would that, what would be some of the negatives? Anything negative about that? Other than the fact that folks would say, if I do that, then what they going to do? See, if the NAACP is paying the premiums, then the beneficiary would be the NAACP. Mm-hmm. Unless they designated something else. But, you know, people, the reluctance I would see if folks want to do that, say, well, if I join in, what they're getting ready to do is kill me. So they can let go of my...
No, but wouldn't you pay the premium?
That's mindset.
But wouldn't you pay the premium? You would just get a better rate if you were part of an organization.
Most folks don't. They couldn't afford it. If they would have had it before Johnny died, so they would have had something to bury him with. So I'm just saying, as an incentive both for the NAACP and that individual to join, you don't have to worry about putting Johnny away. We're going to put him away. And the younger that they are, you would think that the policy would be cheaper for younger folks than it would be for older people, because the bet is, the insurance company is betting you're going to die. The insurance company is betting you're going to live, and you're betting you're going to die. Hmm. And that's what it boils down to, who's going to win.
Well, let me paint a better picture for you. So here's what I would do, you know, in a situation like that, if it's an association, a family, a household is an association because you have the mother, the father, you know, the son, the daughter, mm-hmm. you know, association just means more than one people. But mm-hmm. if you're talking about an organization, then that's different. But I would make the plan portable. What I mean is portable, if you decide to leave that company, leave that organization, you can continue to pay it and keep it. Now, depending on, you know, what do you want, if we're talking universal life, then that's a little bit harder. But a term, you know, there's companies that we with that offers portable group plans where you can take that with you and you don't have to worry about when you leave, it stops.
Why would an organization like NAACP want to give you a portable plan?
Well, it depends on the agent and the company that you're with. You know, it's a lot of different products out there. You know, they might just be, you know, like you said, why would I want to go and drive a Ford when all I know is Chevy? Mm-hmm. You know, they don't want to look and see what else is out there, at least see what their options are. Because it might be more expensive, too, in the cost.
And if you're not paying, as the individual who was the identified paid person to be covered, you're not paying the premium, the organization is paying the premium, why would that be portable? Why would you want to have that, you know, allow that to be portable? Because
you're a member. You're a member, and, you know, when you're a member, those are some of the benefits, you know, they're offering, you know, that benefit, you know, to that person, whether it be, you know, after, you know, 6 months of your service, then you're eligible for, you know, these kind of benefits here, whether it's health insurance, life insurance, a 401k
plan.
You're
looking at it a little different from me. You're looking at, okay, I see what you're saying.
Yeah.
From an individual protection plan. But I'm looking at it from the organization perspective.
There will be the owner, because see, they'll have it to where the reason why it's cheaper for an individual, because you have, you know, the power is in numbers. You know, you have a group of people, you know, and they're paying a certain portion of that cost too, whether it's 50%, 60%, and then you match your, you know, contributing to it. So if your monthly membership fee was $25, nowadays insurance aren't really that expensive unless the older you get, then therefore your cost is going to increase. I've seen plans as less than $14 a month, which, you know, is like a MetLife. MetLife has a very good,
yes,
affordable insurance. I sell MetLife, mm-hmm. but do I have a lot of African Americans coming to an African American agent that's selling a plan that's affordable to them? It's just not, you know, I don't have, mm-hmm. the sheep aren't mm-hmm. coming to where, you know, mm-hmm. the what they call it, they have the sheep, mm-hmm. the sheep horde, the sheep, mm-hmm. man, or what's the sheep
oh,
called?
Shepherd.
The shepherd. They're not coming to the shepherd, mm-hmm. you know, to take care of the sheep. you know,
they're going to the wolf.
and that's the way it is. And it's just, you know, it's something that you just get used to, you know, it's just, you got to adjust to that.
Now, I have another question. Since you mentioned low-cost plans, why is it that when I see the commercials, they're always for people like, if you're over 50, or sometimes it's if you're over 65, and they have these real inexpensive plans, and they say no doctor, you know, no checkup necessary, so you could have diabetes, high blood, you could have everything. How do they give you such inexpensive plans?
That's called guaranteed acceptance, or at least guaranteed insurance. Is what it is a whole life plan. And it's either in increments of 5,000, 10,000, maybe 15, but you're not going to go over 20,000.
Oh, so it's not one of those $100,000 plans that you're going
to
be buying.
You're limited to a certain amount of you know, coverages.
And you have to live how long in order for that to kick in?
There's a 2-year incontestable period, so you got to pay it for 2 years before it's incontestable.
Oh, well, okay, but if you were 57, if you bought a plan at, say, 57, you'd only be 59. And when you say incontestable, meaning you're fully vested, or meaning? Well,
fully vested and full to the point where, you know, you have to disclose if you have an illness or a sickness or something's diagnosed and wrong. Because if you're under false pretenses and you're, you know, trying to think, okay, you're going to hit the lottery on this insurance company, you know, they're going to investigate and they're going to look at the risk. And if they find out, you know, you didn't disclose that.
Then you mean something that you contracted after signing? Because
before you sign, because normally.
But I'm talking about the ones where they say we don't want to know your medical history. I'm amazed that they would let you.
The incontestable period still applies to any policy you have, because, you know, and they have a right to, you know, review your health or at least look at it and say, okay, if you had HIV, there's certain questions that you have to answer. You know, have you been diagnosed or hospitalized within the last 3 or 4 months? If you check no and you just got out of the hospital the day before, that's false pretense.
Okay, so they do ask. It's just that they won't keep you if it's guaranteed acceptance.
It depends on what the question is, and then they can ask for more information to, you know, that question. And if it's, you know, discovered, you know, that, you know, you can't just be a sick person, you know, and just say, okay.
I wondered about that. Yeah, why would you?
There's certain questions. It's just more of an advertising marketing, and that's why they said plans are, you know, underwritten or have to meet eligibility requirements. And that's what the eligibility requirements are. You have to answer those certain questions or questionnaires to be eligible for that particular product or plan.
We definitely have to have Marshawn Govan back. In fact, I know at the African American Museum during Kwanzaa, a lot of people had questions about the affordable health care and their insurance, which was going up. And that, I mean, is that something they can purchase through you, or they can get clarity through you?
We got an online website that don't sleep. You can sign up for health insurance, even if you missed the open enrollment. You know, I'm not here to promote me.
Right.
But we have plans that, you know.
I don't know why not.
I know. Can you tell us where they can go? Because I know, I'm sure people are listening.
They can go to our website. It's www.mkginsuranceagency.com.
Okay.
And, you know, on there we have international medical. So if you're traveling, you're going to Mexico, you're going to Europe, you're going anywhere in the world, and you know you don't want to get sick and go to London and don't have your insurance. We got plans available for you.
Nobody thinks about that.
Won't they care for you anyway?
No.
We have stuff for people that are, you know, students from other countries coming over here, you know, for you know, working, you know, as an exchange student. I mean, we got insurance plans for them, whether it be life insurance, health insurance. We have a short-term medical, which is, you know, 6 months plan up to $2 million coverages. They can go to urgent care. They can go and see a doctor. It just doesn't cover your prenatal and OBGYN stuff. But because open enrollment is ended, we still have those plans after open enrollment for them.
Okay.
And then we have our life
insurance.
That's
key, what you just said. Because I know people still miss the open enrollment because they're either ticked off. Like me, I'm one of those people. I was ticked off at the whole process and trying to get registered 3 or 4 times. You get frustrated. I got frustrated. Yeah. And unfortunately, that was trying to go through the website that the
California coverage.
Yeah, the California coverage. And it was very frustrating for me.
Yeah.
So, I mean, we'd rather go through you, somebody who could just make sure we actually have a plan and not have to keep getting kicked back. I mean, I think that was some of the problems that people
Yeah,
still
even
having.
If they don't qualify or they're not, you know, below the level of that they are exempt from that, we do Medi-Cal there too at our office. And
we
print out your medical cards right there at our office too. So,
bada bim, bada bing. Isn't that what you say, Mel?
We help people from, you know, no income to, you know, getting them a plan. But since open enrollment has ended, you have to have a qualifying event. What that is, you have to lose your job, you have to get pregnant, you have to go through a divorce, you have to gain your citizenship. You know, there's certain criteria for you to be able to sign up for health insurance.
I saw Joel's face when you said
that. Well, no, it's just, you know, why do we do motherhood like that? That's, you know, it's not a great thing. It's like, well, if you die or lose your job or get knocked up.
You know.
But those are some of the things that, that people need to know.
You can still you can sign up after open enrollment, but you have to have a qualifying event. Mm-hmm. And, you know, we have to attest to that. And, you know, it's all, you know, swear under, you know.
So if a person's missed it, probably like me, what do they do? What's the next step? If they've missed open enrollment, they got to wait till the next
You got to wait till November, and you're going to pay the fine. But see, since the Trump administration came in, they kind of proposed what they were going to do, but there's nothing to replace it. But for right now, the law is still into effect. Mm-hmm. Most people are not aware. It's $695. It's up to $2,000 or more for a household. And so it's not a pretty sight. I mean, but at the same time, it's cheaper for some people to pay the fine, but then you don't have that coverage. You know, you can't go to the doctor. We even have PPO dental plans. You know, that's a nice thing to have too, because, you know, you can go anywhere to see any dentist. Vision, we do the vision. You know, those are standalone.
You already got a plan, you can add,
you can add on. You call dual coverage is what I call it. Yeah, so if you're worried about... It depends on your, you know, what kind of plan you want. You know, we offer the United Health vision and dental. We offer the Delta Dental PPO plans.
Yeah.
There's Madison. There's a few other ones. We have the PPO dental. We have also our National General. They have also our accidental medical expense. That's a nice one to have too, because if you're in an accident, it. Your health insurance deductible of $6,000 will come into play. You pay $250 versus your, you know, $6,000. But if you're in an accident, so there's so many blankets. You know, I actually had one gentleman. He came in. He was a driver. He owned it. She was a truck driver. He bundled up on everything. He had the accidental. He had the dental. He had the health. He even bought the critical illness.
Wow.
You know, and that's not a lot of people don't buy that. That's pretty much if you get a sickness or you know cancer, anything going wrong with your organs or a failure. No questions asked. You just file your claim. And it's some of those are effective 30 days to 60 days. So that means if you chose a $20,000, you know, critical illness plan, you go to the doctor, you're diagnosed, you're going to get paid, and you can go and do what you want to do. Go on a trip, pay your mortgage up. You know, it's not like you got to die to just enjoy that money. And that's where the other insurance comes in.
I'm thinking you can plan your funeral.
Yeah, you can. I mean, you know,
and make it a party,
expense, you know, I don't, I mean, you know, we sell stuff that, you know, it involves a lot more work. It involves a lot more questions in it. You know, we're more, like you said, more into that personal, you know, zone, and you have to be comfortable with, you know, looking at what this is going to do, because in the end, you know, you're preparing for your, you know, your end or your maker, but at the same time, your family is going to be well taken care of.
And the funeral itself.
Yeah.
So you won't be doing car washes.
So there are, there are products that you can purchase. Like if you are, if you have an employer plan already, but you have a deductible and all that, there are plans that you can purchase that will
standalone plans. They're outside of that. You know, they're
right. They're outside, but they would cover the deductibles so that
if there's an accident, like the AME, we call it AME, accidental medical expense. If you're in a car accident, you know, you badly bones and stuff, you know, chest cavity, you know, and they got you go into the hospital, you still got to pay your $6,000 health insurance deductible.
But what about planned surgery?
Planned surgery is a little different. You know, when you're saying planned surgery, so that's another thing that we have to do too. We got to also be the we got to look at what your conditions are. Like if you said, okay, I need to see a certain doctor. Let's say, for example, a person that needs to have some MRIs done. We got to make sure that this plan is covered under that, making sure your doctor accepts that plan. So now we're also doing a medical search for the provider, as well as making sure, because I can't sell you a plan that doesn't do you any good, especially if you're telling me, you know, I need to go to a specialist, but then I don't sold you this plan on this name, but then it doesn't, it's not even in your
it
network,
cover.
And it's not, you know, your doctor isn't accepting it, then it becomes a problem on a customer service issue, and then, you know, you're not happy, and then you're dropping it. You know, I like to make sure people are going to keep something, and it's going to benefit them as well.
So the first thing you do, Marshawn, is that you do a total assessment of the individual, see what they need.
Yes.
You don't just try to sell them something. Here, take this.
You can't force feed nobody, you know, plan, because then, you know, you having people come back unhappy and mm-hmm. dissatisfied, and you know, and then you get into a little trouble with that too. So, you know, I got to make sure it's all, you know, document disclosures and what I'm selling. Mm-hmm. And I'm not just licensed in California. Mm-hmm. I'm also licensed in New Mexico. Mm-hmm. I'm licensed in Florida,
okay.
Texas, and California. So, you know.
You're that, Texas,
one state at a time. So if you got family members in any of those states and need some help, and whether it's life insurance, health insurance, you know.
We can send them to you.
You can send them to me.
And, you know, at least one thing I like about Marshawn Govan, he's right on the corner. So we're able to walk to his office and get signed up. But either way, you're local, where people can reach you, even throughout the Central Valley and, of course, in those other states.
It's like you said earlier, you know, I can be the shepherd, you know, for anybody, whether you're, you know, Latino, African-American, you know, whatever it is, you know, I'm going to kind of tell you, you know, the facts. And, you know, you can take that information, give you a proposal. There's some very good products out there, mm-hmm. some stuff that people never really heard of or not really was privileged to, or at least had the opportunity mm-hmm. to be exposed to that. And if they were, you know, had enough income, or if they want to really save for the future, you know, they can change their economical situation around. And it takes about 10 years. And from 10 years from now or 6 years from now, you know, depending on, like, for her, Jules' example, you know, you want to retire early and,
Preferably before 67.
You know, you have a certain window here, and of course, you know, you're not trying to. You're going to be trying to play catch up, and there, you know,
I know.
A 401k is not going to do that for you. So you need another instrument.
That's why I want the Roth. I want to invest.
That's a good instrument too, but at the same time, you're missing a bigger instrument. I would look at, you know, the annuities, and then also mm-hmm. some of the riders and stuff that they have on there. You know, there's good companies out there like Allianz. There's, you know, American Equity.
Okay.
There's a lot of different companies out there that are offering you, you know, like incentives. So if you're saying, mm-hmm. are you going to guarantee get, you know, 4 to 5% bonus or even a 10% mm-hmm. bonus your first year? And then the rest of your years, you're guaranteed to get 3 to 4% on your income.
Really? That's a lot.
So I
have to do is call MKG Insurance
Agency. That's right.
And make an appointment for a general fiscal physical.
I like that though. I like
exactly.
that. That's what they're
and, you know, we, since I'm an agent,
what do we need to bring?
Well, good point. That's a good question.
I would tell you like this. If you have a 403B statement or mm-hmm. 401k statement, you can bring that to me and let me look at that. Because we're good at, you know, looking mm-hmm. at that. Whether even if it's you're in Edward Jones, you're in Charles Schwab's, if you got that stuff, you know, don't worry mm-hmm. about it. We got clients that have $100,000 or more invested, and they come to us mm-hmm. to get their taxes done. Now, you know, it's like
you
I
guys
said.
Do taxes
they do tax. We didn't even touch it.
Yeah, we're on a tax like side and insurance, minutes. So we're diversified. So we take
I'll
care
say.
Of the taxes, we take care of the insurance, we take care of the automobile, we take care of your home, we take
you
care.
You know who I'm thinking about?
Who are you thinking about?
You're thinking about people who look like they're self-employed and they're not making no contributions other than what they give to their church mm-hmm. every now and then.
Well, there's a big misconception right now with the tax season mm-hmm. going on, and most okay. people are thinking, well, after the 15th, I'm gonna go file my taxes, then the IRS. Gonna give me, you know what? You're in a queue. Mm. What that means is you're a number billion whatever in the list. And right now they already said that they're $54 billion withholding people's refunds.
Wow.
And so the later you file, the later you're gonna get your money. Mm. The sooner you file, the sooner you're gonna get your money because you're in a system to be processed and it's a waiting list. And so you know,
I'm not even talking about that. I'm talking about people who are self-employed who could benefit. The community by making a contribution. Say, Valley Black Talk Radio, you make your contribution to them and you write that off as advertisement. If you got it, and a lot of folks who don't even know that, they don't know that, you know, they'd rather give Uncle Sam that money.
Well, there's a brain surgery to that part too. When it comes to businesses, you know, depending on if you are a business, not to say, you know, you're not, but if you're a business, I like to look at your bank statements because mm-hmm. if you can't remember what you spent your money on, there goes the brain surgery, or there goes the financial tax surgery coming on place. So every little dime, penny, you know, we have a little budget. We have a budget a spreadsheet where we plug in everything, and it gives us an overall number and a picture, and it goes from month to month, day to day. We take care of everything from your expenses from January all the way till December, and we comb through that because we don't want to make sure that we, you know, get anybody out of it under false pretenses, let alone under, you know, information that isn't accurate, because we got to be accurate. because, you know, we got to make sure that we're, you know, representing our clients.
But what you're asking is about businesses in general. Yeah. Don't know some of the specifics.
Yeah, but we have an organizer for a business. Mm-hmm. If you, you know, you can email us, call us. We'll give you a free tax organizer. We'll give you an expense organizer. We'll give you some advice. We do bookkeeping service. We'll, you know, make sure you get your expenses in order. You know, whatever you need, you know, when it comes to the life insurance or the business owner policy insurance, you know, that's another thing people don't overlook. You know, if they making at least $10,000, mm-hmm. and let's say you get sick, you get hurt, mm-hmm. you can't pay your, you can't work, you don't eat, right? Mm. What if you knew you had insurance that would cover your rent, cover your mortgage, cover your employees, pay for all that stuff? It's called business owner expense insurance. Mm-hmm. Most people are not aware of that, you know, but it doesn't come with a cheap price tag. But it's just so many, you know, so much that, you know, we can advise a person on. We're just not, you know, like you said, a cookie cutter tax shop or a cookie cutter insurance shop. Mm-hmm. You know, mm-hmm. we're here to, you know, give you a service that, you know, you ain't going to be going to, you know, Joe's shop over here, you know, Alan's shop over there, you know.
You're one stop.
One stop, mm-hmm. multi-service financial service company.
I know who you're talking about. I know what you're doing.
Yeah,
I know. Well, get to your last question because it's 8 o'clock.
No,
and so,
I'm
are you sure you don't want to?
Yeah.
All right.
I need to get them hooked up.
So he needs to get hooked up with Marshawn
exactly.
as soon as possible.
Yes.
I mean, ASAP, because he's going to know it all. Man, so this is what we meant by black economics. And you mm-hmm. thought, Jewel thought she was going to be able to add to the conversation.
Yeah, she was going to do it. If we had
this. Oh, I didn't. But wait, back to my question, though. And I'm just asking for our audience, because I'll find out when I call. But so
minute.
I probably need like a 401, whatever.
Your annual statement. They should give you an annual statement.
Okay.
Or your
a budget.
Maybe my
a budget.
You know, something from my mortgage, so we know how much I'm paying and what the, and maybe.
Would it be a budget of my bills per se?
Yes, yeah, something
in my household?
That shows. We know what my output.
We got a family monthly budget for that. You know, we can email it to you.
And I just fill it in.
You fill it in. We talk about from your groceries,
that's
your
great.
Gas,
then you
your
don't
credit
have to carry
card.
All that stuff around.
You can email it. You know, everything we try to do is all online. Mm-hmm. So, you know, you can email it, send it back to us. Mm-hmm. You can print it out from home. You can even have it on your computer so it's able to help you understand your finances. Because, like I said, until you really figure out what's going in, what's going out, and that, you know, you can kind of have that visualization mm-hmm. of your economic situation, then you're able to, you know, move forward and you can make adjustments and you can kind of improve on that.
So I would like to say, oh, go ahead.
He's the black Dave Ramsey.
Yeah. Or Clark. What's his name?
Yeah,
the other guy.
Yeah, I mean we're pretty sharp where we're at, and you know we're not all, you know, with the, you know, high rise towers or anything like that, but you know we're gonna be just as thorough and just as, you know, mm-hmm. professional, and you
and
know,
you're gonna be giving your money to black folks,
and yeah. then you're gonna invest into another black company, and that's another thing. Mm-hmm. You know, a lot of people aren't knowing where the black businesses are, mm-hmm. you know, because economic power comes in numbers, and if mm-hmm. we can invest into ourselves and not just go to the name brands, I mean, we also able to create jobs, you know, mm-hmm. for our own, you know, black community or black businesses.
Because you have a staff.
I have a staff and
See?
I have an overhead, and, you know,
so?
We don't discriminate, you know, mm-hmm. we're equal opportunity too, but it also allows us to, you know, be able to, if we're able to donate and, you know, give to those charitable organizations, and we operate at, we have a nonprofit too. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, we're so diversified. And like I say, just people aren't really, you know, spending their money, you know, with black-owned businesses. They're not definitely filing their taxes with all the black-owned businesses. And there's only a few in Fresno. Mm-hmm. They're not going to all the black-owned, you know, life insurance companies. But I think we're the only ones that I know that's the only black-owned life insurance company.
Do you guys do homeowners policies?
We
too?
Do auto home. We actually offer MetLife auto home and, you know, business. We do everything that, you know, any other companies would do. If you had your farmers, if you had your what's the other one, your
State Farm.
Mm-hmm. We do everything that they can do.
Travelers, it's time
Travelers.
For me to change over.
Oh well, you know what? Guess what? The museum needs a new policy.
Yeah,
say that out loud.
We do buildings insurance, business
okay.
insurance. We do it.
Nonprofits.
All. Nonprofits.
Okay.
You know, we do everything that any one of the farmers, any one of the, you know, State Farms can do. We're just on a local level, and we're a black-owned business that are really not recognized for the services that we offer or mm-hmm. what we do in the community.
But now you are.
If a tree falls in the forest, does it make a noise?
Yes.
If nobody heard it, the answer, we know what the true answer is.
Well, you know, we've been advertising, you know, on radio, on TV, on YouTube. You can find us on YouTube. You can go on YouTube. You know, YouTube, you can Google us. I mean, it's no secret. It's just, you know, like I said.
I think it has to do with the interest of what sometimes our community.
It's a name brand. People like name brand.
And with the line of business, because we generally, you know, don't save or have insurance, as you're saying. But what I love is we were at the other place the last time you were here. That was like 2 years ago, and you still floating.
But it'd be nice to float with more support.
Definitely.
And and that's the reason why we wanted to have him on the show. People can see he is the expert in what
and
he
we're
does.
Not we're not it's not like, you know, he's damaged. This is a great business, so it's not.
You have to have it. You really do.
Yeah, you got to do it anyway. And look, don't wait until you turn 52 either. Because like you say, you end up playing catch-up.
Right. Yep. So we'd like to thank Marshawn Govan, MKG Insurance. That's where you can find him. He's online. That website one more time, please.
Well, the insurance website is www.mkginsuranceagency.com.
That whole thing. Okay, make sure you get the agency at the end. Mm-hmm. And we appreciate you coming on the show and educating us and our viewers on what is it we need to do to get financially sound. Yeah. Folks, this is just economics part one. Okay? We could have went on for another half hour because I know Julia had some more questions and I know Mel had some more questions. I can see both of their faces and I had to cut them both off. That's terrible, right?
I'm going to ask mine in the office.
See that? And so we appreciate that, and we have to support our experts. The folks that are right here or that are reachable, even if you're not in Fresno and you're watching, because we do have our Philmont and Black Trade Line audiences. So even if you're watching somewhere in California or somewhere outside of California, Texas, Florida,
New Mexico.
Okay, any of those states, you can definitely call Marshawn Govan. We wish that you would, because we wouldn't have him on the show if he wasn't that expert. Right. And so we're going to keep calling on you, if that's okay, every few months or so to keep us up on our game, to make sure that we are reaching out to you and also that our audience has someone to be able to fall back on, such as you.
Yep, I appreciate it. And the only thing I can leave with the listeners out there, if you are listening, is just look up Rule 72 and Rule 108.
Okay.
And that's my, you know, or at least my advice, you know, to anybody that want to know about economics, how you interpret it, how you take that information home. Pass it on to your kids, you know, kind of that's something, you know, you want to talk with your household about, because we don't learn those things until, you know, it's almost too late and we don't live our life.
Again, we do appreciate Marshawn Govan. You'll have to join us on Sunday for part two in economics. We're going to be talking about credit. Can't go anywhere, because we are going to have Reggie from Credit Pulse, and Mel, you got to see him as well. Right. So some more experts, y'all. We're trying to introduce you all to the experts so you can give them a call and get rolling, get on your feet. You want to know how to do it? Yeah. We're telling you. We're giving you the people to do it so you can go to them, call them, and do what you got to do to get started.
Yeah.
Stop playing. Get up. Get up off of those feet. We'd like to thank you for watching this edition of Valley Black Talk Radio, State of Black Central Valley Economics. We also thank all of our other expert, John Brown, who did call in. And we also thank the viewing audience. We'll see you on Sunday. Have a great weekend.